All right, okay. What is going on? We are here for another instance of live sampling talk. Hope everything's well with you. Hope everything's going good. Hope everything is going as well as it can. Man, oh man. Let me know if I am streaming. Let me know if everything is going all right. Let me know if you can hear me. I can hear me. All right, cool. We are here. We are here. We're here. What's going on, Isomatic? What's going on, Static? What's going on, Gert? What's going on, Blade? All right, good, 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 good. Just checking everything that I'm here, making sure everything's going good. This is a casual live stream where we talk nothing but samplers. If sampling is your thing, and making music samplers with samplers is your thing, especially with the vintage variety, this is the place for you to be. But if you are into samplers in general, all types of samplers, this is where you need to be. Glad you are here. Hope your weekend is going well. Hope everything is going well with you. Everything's going well with me. You can hear? Okay, wicked. That is good to know. You never know with these things, so I always gotta double check. All right. Okay. So, oh man. Once again, hope your weekend is going good. Hope everything is well with you artistically and with your life. Man, I had a pretty good week. I don't know if I should start with the news or start with a quick update. Let us start with a quick update. So I finally got this computer fired up. I got the audio card in. Everything works. Everything's good. It is working the way I expect it to work. It's blazing fast and all that sort of stuff. And I'm just still you never think getting a computer takes so long. It really doesn't. It's just me. But I'm really trying to get it just to be a mirror image of the computer I am on right now. So I'm still on my old computer, but we're getting there. We're going good. And I'll tell you one thing about, what I use the beginning of the calendar year for. It's usually generally a time that I use to sort of work up to top speed. So I never start off the year at full blast. I usually start pretty quietly and sort of like, try to get myself in order. So the fact that this lined up with that time of year is wicked for me. So I'm not really in a rush to get the computer up and running, especially working Dawlessly. I can work on my music anytime independent of a computer. Isn't that great? I have to depend on it nothing but for business. So it's almost there. It's almost there, and I'm going to test it and test it until I'm ready just to completely make the move and get this computer out of here. So that is the update with the computer so far. As far as music is going, it is started on another song, and that's going good. Everything is going good. So we'll start with the news. Right out the gate, if you have not signed up to the Daydream Sound mailing list, I invite you to. I mail quite frequently, I would say weekly, depending on the list you're on. It's a great way for me to let you know what's going on and let me share my thoughts behind the scenes that I wouldn't really share in the, I mean, there's no other way to share those sort of thoughts or anything news like that online other than verbally like now. But I would invite you to do so at thedaydreamsound.com. That information is linked at the top of this chat here, also in the description box below. But news, news, news. Right now, at thedaydreamsound.com, episode 233 of the Samplers Podcast is up and running. The title is called Overworked. Overworked in music, overworked in general. How do you manage your work rate so that you can have longevity in music? That's the big task. That's the big deal. This is what episode 233 talks about. Now, if you don't know, I run an operated podcast called the Samplers Podcast, which is not this live stream. It's a completely different podcast, independent of what we're doing here and completely exclusive to the daydreamsound.com, and it's called the Samplers Podcast. We are 233 episodes deep into that podcast, and episode 233 is titled Overwork. Definitely a great listen, especially if you are even remotely thinking of doing music on any type of level and find yourself just can't get the ball rolling, don't know how to keep it going. this is the episode to listen to. I would invite you to listen to the podcast anytime. It's a short form podcast, so it's, you know, they range from about 10 minutes. There are artist interviews that go, you know, roughly around the 2 hour mark. But aside from that, it is a short form podcast. That is the news. There's nothing else going on for me other than what I've just discussed. It's music time for me, working time for me, and that's a good thing. But in general, take yourself down to thedaydreamsound.com. There's tons of stuff going on down there. Tons, always. It's like a sampler wonderland over there. What's going on, Cool V? You good? Good to see you, man. What's going on, Roy? What's going on? What's going on, John? Yeah, man, we're doing good, it seems. You just listened to the latest podcast, Great Analysis and Advice, and find myself still in a situation once in a while. Yeah, man, it's the craziest thing. Like, when you really begin to decide to do music, it's very, or any type of independent work, you know, setting up a system that works or understanding how to keep things moving, it's not as easy as you think because you don't think about it, especially when it comes to something like music. Music just seems like, for the most part, it's what everyone, you know, within this sort of space thinks is easy, meaning that if you have all your time, so you think, just to do music, then you've won the lottery. It's like the easiest thing in the world. And while it is an absolute fortunate blessing, it is by no means easy, and it requires just as much structure as anything else. And that's where reality kicks in. So it has to be done in a way that that you can actually deal with. What's going on, Burkhardt? What's going on, Jamal, in the virtual building? What's going on, man? You good? Oh man, wicked to see everyone here, man. Thanks for really having an interest in hanging out with me during this sort of, or about this sort of topic. It's absolutely amazing. Which reminds me, last week we discussed the idea in the general store of bundling things, and that's exactly what I did with the History Never Gets Old cassette and Gold Revelation. So if you check the general store right now, that is bundled at a wicked, wicked price. It's dope. I bundled things in the past a long time ago, and I don't know why I took it down, but it's back because it was suggested, and I think it's a great idea. So in the future, I'm going to bundle other stuff, especially anything physical, obviously. I'm going to bundle them so that, number one, it's more of a discount, it's more efficient, but things like that get purchased together anyway, and that's got to be a beast, like on shipping and stuff like that. But if I combine them, it's just a win-win for everybody. So check out the general store when you have a moment. And if you have any suggestions on things I can bundle, I haven't really thought of a clever way to bundle the Carpenter's Sawdust because it's sort of like its own product. It's aside from the music, so it's like on its own. I haven't figured that out yet. But I do sales every now and then. But definitely take yourself down to the Daydream Sound General Store and have yourself a gander, especially for the music, and see what you like. But thanks for the suggestion. I can't remember who it was that suggested it, but much appreciated. Yeah, when I just knocked that out last week, and I was like, yep, we're doing this. What's going on, Gert? For me, you think something that helps was realizing that it's okay to walk away from gear. You find a lot of work done just meditating on a music idea before sleep or on a walk. Yeah, well, music on a whole, all of that has to be managed, though, because, yeah, it does work. All of these things, you sort of figure out your way of working. The key is, in general, is to actually think about that sort of stuff a lot. There's a lot of logistics that goes into making music, and it gets more complicated when you decide to do music as a career sort of thing, because then there's a lot of things that have to be considered from an entrepreneurial standpoint, where it is a job, and a lot of things have to be managed. Nonetheless, your time, right? So it's a crazy thing. And if you don't look at it that way, you're going to be overworked and then you're just going to stop. And that's the worst thing to do. Not all creativity needs to be structured. Execution is challenging with making music. Yeah, it's a thing because we don't naturally want to do it. It kind of goes against what we've come to know artists to be. You know, you think of an artist, you don't think of somebody structured. You know, it just doesn't. It's not a natural thing to look at musicians that way. You know, we tend to be looked at as sort of like these, you know, free, unrestricted people that just do what we want. And that's not really true. I guess we're that way at heart. I don't know. I don't know. But, you know, in practice, it's a different look. I'll tell you that much. You just did that today. Let the studio just to catch a breath after not accomplishing anything. Yeah. You have to think about what you're doing when you're going in the studio. The studio's not it's not an answer. You know, just walking into the studio a lot of the times doesn't help. You know what I mean? If you don't have a plan. So it sort of, if anything, intensifies things when you actually step in the space. And you're right, it's good to step outside of it because it can number one, put things in order, but it can relieve a lot of that sort of nervous tension that you may have to perform when you get in the studio or make use of the time. And you're right, you don't always have to make like that much use of the time. You just have to once again manage it. So the newest podcast was from TDS was perfect. Much appreciated, man. Yeah. I like the scope of the Samplers podcast because it covers everything, you know, especially concerning musician life. Because it's not just about like, you know, getting a sampler or even making music. There's so much more that goes into all of that, that if you can know about those things, it makes the path to actually getting to the music a lot more easier. And it's not surprising. What's going on, LD40 man? You straight? Good to see you, man. Absolutely. Was not sure today what to do and just, and that's what got you fired. Oh, wicked, man. That's dope. You know, that's crazy. Much appreciated. Dope, 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 dope. Okay, man. Well, there is one thing. Hold on, hold on, hold on. Sorry, y'all. Oh my goodness. I was talking all this time and there was no audio? I'm so sorry. Sorry, y'all. Oh my goodness. I was giving an amazing monologue and all the audio was gone. Oh my goodness. Sorry, y'all. This is oh man. How long was I talking with no audio? Oh, that's terrible. I will start again. I feel so bad. This sampler is called the audio frame. The audio frame was an 80s sampler. This is the height of sampling technology in 1988. Oh my goodness, I just caught myself and just realized, how long was I gone? 5 minutes. Oh my goodness, I gave the biggest monologue on this sampler of my life. Let's do it again, okay? That's the way these things go. Oh my stars, because I wasn't even looking at the stream or anything. I was just talking, as I usually do. I should look at the stream more often. I just was looking at my levels and I was like, the meters aren't moving. Am I muted? Terrible. Anyway, this is the audio frame. The audio frame was an 80 sampler. Not as popular as the PPG Waveterm or the Synclavier or the Fairlight, but it was an amazing sampler. You can actually hear this sampler online today. There is somebody who has posted up a video. Apparently they owned one and they actually have recordings made with this amazing sampler. Now, if you look at this, it's nearly 11 rack spaces big and it is absolutely madness. Now, when I tell you that samplers were the precursors to DAWs, this is why. You're looking at a sampler right now. You're not looking at a DAW. And you're looking at something made in 1988. You see the mainframe and you see the computer in the background. It's sequenced like a computer. It had an operating system just like, sorry, like a DAW and everything. Operated very much like a DAW does today, except it was a sampler. 16-bit. Absolutely insane. It's called the audio frame. It's one of the samplers that just got swept under the rugs in the 80s. We don't talk about it much because I've never seen much people talk about it. It's a very, very obscure sampler, but this is the audio frame. Now, back to what I was saying. Take a look at the back of it. Absolutely insane, the inputs and outputs on the back, all XLR. You can see 4 MIDI ports, you can see serial ports, lots of ins and outs, graphical display screen interface from a computer. Insane stuff, and it actually sounds amazing when you hear it. It had everything that you could imagine in the 80s. Now, when I saw this, I was like, well, look at where we were and look at where we are now when we see gear that doesn't even match this in hardware. The reason why is because, one, we have DAWs now that very much represent and are similar to this now. This is sort of the standard way a DAW looks, minus the mainframe, because our computers are the mainframe. But DAWs have replaced this sort of thing. But it would be nice to see this sort of ambitiousness in samplers. Absolutely insane stuff. So this is called the audio frame. Very, very obscure samplers in 1988. This was made. And just to give you an idea of how much it cost $88,000. 80s dollars. This did. So you can see how serious of a thing sampling was back then. And when you hear me speak about how, you know, we were doing amazing in the 80s and then we just sort of went down, we did. And this is an example of it. This is just an absolute crazy powerhouse of a sampler. Once again, I encourage you to look it up on, you know, whenever you have a chance. Thanks y'all for sticking with me with this, man. I can't believe my audio was gone. I'm so perturbed about that, but we're good now. This was a powerhouse of a sampler. definitely invite you to check it out on your own time. It's called the Audio Frame. The company is called Wave Frame Corporation. Now, this company is still active today. They make software. They don't make hardware anymore. But this company is actually still operating right now as we speak. But, you know, definitely check it out. Really, really, really good stuff. That is what I wanted to share as a bit of sampler history as we move into stuff. Oh, boy. Thanks for sticking with me, y'all. Much appreciated. What's going on, Adrenaline? Holy smoke. Oh, y'all held it down, man. I thought you guys were all going to bounce. Much appreciated. Holy smoke. Much appreciated, y'all. Are some of those XLRs ASU? I don't know. I don't even know if that standard was available in 1988. I have no clue. I was just more, you know, impressed with the fact that this sampler actually, you know, like I didn't know about it. I found out about this probably about like last fall. And when I found it, I was like, I've never heard anyone talk about this. I just don't know. And it's difficult to find any information on it. And you definitely, I have never seen one in real life, like in video or something like that. I've never seen video. There's only pictures of this thing. But luckily, online, right now on YouTube, there's audio of it. So you can hear what it sounds like. And it just sounds so 80s. It's so good. But this is a, you know, this is what I mean. There's so many things in samplers history that we just don't, that just, you know, they got swept under the rug. Like, and this is one of them. Absolutely crazy. Like, look at it. Absolutely crazy, crazy piece of technology. You compare that to what we have today. And you can see that all the power has gone into the computer. This is where the future, you saw it going this way. And this is why you could say we have powerful DAWs today and hardware has dwindled. And this was sort of like a marker of that, if you were just looking back at it in hindsight, you know. 1988, everyone. Insane stuff. Okay. Oh, man. What kind of application was that sampler applied to? Just straight up sampling. It was like a DAW. So it was much like a workstation. You can look at this as sort of like a precursor to Pro Tools or something like that, but it was basically a sampling workstation. So after samplers sort of got solidified as, you know, recording and playing back stuff, then they really start to go crazy. And that's sort of what the ASR-10 is, right? The ASR-10 is, you know, has some of that sort of thing where it's a workstation. You can record and sequence in there and do all, you could complete a whole project. This is what that sort of thing was at its highest level, which very much represents a DAW. You don't think about it now because DAWs are just normal, but you have to, you know, when you really think about the idea that, you know, the fact that there was no such thing as a DAW, there was no DAWs. There was, you know, digital tape at the very best, but the common thing was 24-track analog reels. That's what you recorded your music to. You know, and as technology got more and more efficient, the idea of actually recording in the computer became very, very real. Expensive, but real. And this is something, you know, the wave term was just, it encapsulated all of that. You know, that's why I like looking at it and speaking about it, because it doesn't, as you can see, it didn't spare any expense. Like, that is a masterpiece. So I'd encourage everyone to look into that, especially if you could find any other samplers of that nature and that sort of class that we may have missed over the years. Because this one slipped under my radar literally up until last year. I didn't know this existed. And the thing that's confusing about it is there is the PPG wave term. Everyone knows about that because PPG is a massive company, but and it still sort of carries on today through Waldorf. But Waveframe, like I never heard of that company until last year. And this sampler, I definitely did not know about it at all. It's absolutely insane. While there's very little, yeah, there's, when I tell you it's rare, it's super rare. Like I did not know about this. And like I don't claim to know everything, but at least you're going to hear something in passing. I've never heard about this sampler till last year. And that's the reason I found out of it was about it was like extensive digging. And I found it by mistake. Because when I saw it, it doesn't look like a sampler. So you're like, oh, that's just some sort of beginning of a DAW. When you research it, you're like, it's a complete standalone sampler. That's what it looked like. And then you're like, okay, you know what I mean? You start digging into it. There's very little you could find on this sampler. And that's why I'm sort of talking about it here, because if anyone could find somebody who actually has one of these and would be kind enough to put video up online, that would be great. If you could find video of this online, like I said, there's audio examples of it on YouTube, but I've never seen this thing like somebody touching it. There's only pictures. And you'll see that the pictures that you see are pretty much the ones that I've just shown you. It's just different variations of that picture. And that was the marketing sort of, the picture that I shown was like their picture. Like that's the one that they put in magazines and stuff. But like, I've never seen one of these in somebody's studio before, you know? So this is sort of like the ultra rare of the rare of audio, but you know, absolutely insane stuff. Oh, well. I think that does justification. Not as good as the first monologue I did about it, but it pretty much did recap everything that I said initially. Once again, I apologize for the time going out. That was crazy. Things happen. It's online. Never mind. We're here. We're here now. You read? Yes, Peter Gabriel did it. Of course, Stevie Wonder used everything. You'd literally have to talk to him or Peter Gabriel to even like, and that's the thing, because of the price of it, it's not like you would have this sort of sampler. Like the average person would never have this. This is like world-class artist, world-class studio type gear. It's not, and that's what makes it more rare. It's because you would have to be extremely rich to even be in the same room with this sort of thing. So it makes it even more difficult now to know even where one of these are. I can't find any information on how many were made, you know, nothing. It's really, really, the specs, everything is out there. Like you can find the specs, no problem. But actually like, where is one now? Tough. It's tough to find. What's good, y'all? What's good, Luis, man? You good? From Mexico. Oh, wicked, man. Good, good, good. Amazing that you're tuning in from Mexico, man. Yeah, enjoy your vacation. That's dope. Nice. You remember this, but the first time you've seen pictures, thanks. Yeah, man. Found an article about it from 1989. I can post the link. Yeah, I have the articles. I found every piece of write-up on it. I would just like to see it, you know, a video of it. But that's dope, you know. Yeah, there's a good bit, like I'm saying, there's a good bit of write-ups, but they're all sort of the same. You know, I think SOS Magazine did a write-up on it that I have. There's a good bit of like information. Waveframe isn't an unknown company. And like I said, they're active right now. But it's hard to find that sort of, the actual hardware online. Maybe reaching out to the company, maybe I'll, you know, shoot them an email if they'd be, you know, kind enough to answer, because I really want to know more about this thing. Absolutely insane. The Rayframe had a big and very cool looking MIDI controller for it too. 120. Oh, really? I haven't seen one of those. It is pretty cool. Nice. Yeah, you're out here on with your lady and your daughter for 16th birthday. Nice. Good, man. Very good that you're doing Sweet 16. Oh, that's amazing. You got some downtime and that's, oh, nice, man. Absolutely dope. Yeah, man. So that is what I wanted to kick the show off with, along with 5 minutes of silence. Oh, that's so classic. Now, what else have I got on the? Oh yeah. So anyway, this stream is a wonderful place where if you have any questions about samplers that you think I'd be able to help with, or any of us, feel free to ask. Now is the best time. I'm usually, if you shoot me an email about questions, they're difficult for me to answer. I don't have that much time, but here's the ideal place to do it. Now, outside of the manuals is also the second ideal place, but let's say you're not on any of the manuals in the discussion section. This is the precisely amazing place to ask any questions about sampling and that sort of thing, or samplers and that sort of thing. And with that, I suppose I should get on to the Q&A. We got tons of questions that I dug up. If you'd like to, I think I should get into that. There wasn't that much that happened this week that I should speak about. Is there just nothing? No, man, it's been quiet. It's been quiet. I think everyone's waiting for Superbooth. We got a couple months to go and then it's going to go crazy again. But as far as questions, I got tons and tons of questions. So I'll get into those and then we'll get into chat. Once again, if you have questions about samplers, anything, if you want my opinion on something, my thoughts on something, anything that you think that my thoughts would be interesting for you to hear, definitely ask away. But first question from online is this. This is from my Sun Sign Astrology video. And, well, I'll read the question because it's sort of, you know, I for those of you that also do, I do have a good interest in astrology, enough of an interest, definitely a fascinating thing to pay attention to. And Mr. Jen asks, can you make more of these videos? Now, here's the thing about astrology and sort of any type of thing that would be considered esoteric or occultish. Because of that, those two words I say, it wears out a lot of people that are traditionally religious. And it sort of scares them. Or it also actually freaks out people more that you would consider atheist. I would say it has more of an adverse effect on them than it does people who are traditionally religious. And because of that, there can be sort of a sort of division that happens in the comments, where of all of the videos I make, these are sort of the most controversial, believe it or not, than anything, where I speak about astrology and how to sort of figure out your style of making music or your artistic sort of strengths through the time you were born at. Now, for those of you who are into astrology more than anything, I could understand how it seems like it's just sort of airy-fairy or even sort of ungrounded. But if you look at it simply as you being, if you look at your birth time as part of a cycle, depending on what time you were born, different things were happening and they affect the way, I'm not even going to get into it. But that's why I don't make too much astrology videos. But what I could do for anyone that's interested is if you want me to sort of look at your chart and we can talk about what I would see as your strengths depending on the time you were born, that would be interesting. Because then you could see it right there and then. And you could tell me whether I'm just, you know, making it up or not. But I could tell you how I could interpret your chart and how artistically your strengths would play out in your life. Because we all have different things that we use as strengths. And a lot of it can be seen through your birth chart, if that is your side of things. So I might, you know, do something like that later on in the day. Your mom's natal chart and what she revealed to me is extremely, extremely, I can't see. On the spot? Spot on with how it played out in your life. Yeah, it's not that deep. It's not magic. It's not anything like that. It's pretty interesting, you know, when you get into it. Next question is from the Roland MC303 filtered bass and synthesizers drone. It's no secret. The MC303 by Roland is like the ultimate fun box to me. It's my guilty pleasure. It sounds amazing. It's incredibly cheap. And it's just one of those things that I liked right from the get-go. I saw it. So I had to get one, and I did get one, and I made a couple a good handful of videos here on YouTube about it. So noodling around 2023 says, great channel, thanks. I've been offered one of these for 180 British pounds. Is that a fair price? Thanks. I think 180 pounds for a MC303 is really overpriced. I just think that's too much. Like I couldn't see. I think that's way too much for one of these things. While there was a lot of them made, and I guess they're popular, I think that's too much. And I don't think Roland distribution is. I don't think Roland stuff is hard to come by in the UK for something to be that much. Like, that's a lot of money. I'm just thinking about how much I paid for mine. I just think 180 is way too much for MC303. I think if you looked, you'd find one way cheaper. So that's my opinion on that, even though I think it's just, it sounds really good, but, you know, that's kind of, it has so much going against it. It was really a prototype, not to mention it's actually the first groove box, namely so by Roland. So there's a lot of firsts with it, but there's a lot of things that are just, you know, there's a reason why, you know, it's very underdeveloped. Let's put it that way. But there's so much good stuff that you can go on. And I think part of the quirkiness of it all is what makes it just fun to work with. The absolute frustrations of it actually make it the actual strong points of it. But 180 pounds for this, I don't think so. Maybe some of the other ones that built on this, but not this. Next question is on my Mob Bap, why get into Mob Bap video. So it's a modular boom bap, an introduction to modular hip hop. So if those of you who don't know, the term Mob Bap was phrased by Corey, whose company is named Mob Bap Modular. But when he got into making hip hop with modular, he popularized and created the term Mod Bap, which stuck. And we use that till this day to identify the genre of using modular gear to make hip hop. Now, I would love to see so many more people get into modular that are in the hip hop field, but there's really, 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 I don't know if to call it fair apprehension. It just hasn't gotten figured out yet, and it may get there. There's a lot of popular people. I'd say Ski Beats sort of, you know, I would say is one of the more popular mainstream producers who have embraced it, but it's a tough uphill battle. So CC FIPP asked, why doesn't everyone do this? And that is the answer why. Modular hasn't, in my opinion, like my assessment of it all is, it hasn't been made cool yet. It's very difficult to make modular look cool. One, because of the history that it has. It's just seriously like a, you know, it's the nerdiest of the nerd end of the pool when it comes to synthesis. But essentially, it's one of those things that looks intimidating, even though it's way more simpler than anything. That's the sort of the craziness of it all. Modular is as easy as it gets, like, but it looks complicated once it's all set up. And two, it requires a pretty in-depth understanding of synthesis. So you can't really fake modular, I would say. You can make any patch you want, and I think that's where the faking comes in. Like, you could patch anything and something will happen, but to actually be able to turn out real good music on modular, you have to kind of know what you're doing. And that sort of puts the cap off on a lot of people, especially now, because now more than ever, you really don't have to know what you're doing to make music. But with any type of sort of bass level synthesis instrument, you have to know something when you're actually patching something. You have to know everything. And more importantly, if you're not buying a modular system and you're buying stuff piece by piece, well, you even have to know what you're doing even to buy a modular system. You got to know a lot about synthesis, because what you buy is your instrument piece by piece. So you have to know it. So that's would be my answer to it. One, it's not cool enough. It's getting there, and it's going to take a while. And I think all good things do take a while to blow up and become embraced. But a lot of it is an intimidation factor, and a lot of it is an understanding factor that a lot of people don't have the patience for, and they're not really going to stick with it that long to really master it. But those who are have seen the rewards. Like, it's just like, you know, you watch a good modular hip-hop set, you know, if any of you wanting to know more about this, I would say check out Voltage Controller. Check out Corey, check out Flux, check out, you know, he doesn't post that much, but Upright is one of the first people that I've really seen go off, you know, in modular, before it was even called Modbap. But he's, you know, to me, he's one of the, I wouldn't say unsung, but he's, you know, one of the masters. Of course, D-Steel, all the people that I've interviewed on the Samplers podcast are kind of, you know, really front runners in the Modbap field. And of course, Ski Beats as well, you know, but easy stuff to find, you know, the greats in the genre. But that would be my answer. All right. Next question. This is, again, okay, from 20 Minutes of Modular Noise. And Oliver Morris, this is a video where I've just pretty much did a traditional noise piece on my 5U modular. Which essentially a noise piece is just you make a patch that sounds interesting. So it's a cross between drone music, but it's a little bit more aggressive, dipping into the noise genre. And with that genre, you could just explore so much in sound. It's sort of like live sound design is what I would call it. But he says, what's the piece of hardware you are using in this video? Well, my modular synthesizer is a synthesizers.com who has switched hands at this point. Not my gear, but the company has switched owners. But it's called a synthesizer.com system. I built it myself. I ordered the pieces myself, and it came as a system. But it's basically a set of modular pieces. So there's two oscillators, a ladder filter, audio input, two envelopes, and a VCA on it. That's my system. And a MIDI interface. And from that, I can create so many things. It's including a lot of logic functions. So it's really, really more than just a synthesizer, like way more than a synthesizer. But that's what it is. It's in 5U format. So it's a lot bigger than what you would see in the Eurorack world. Should I pause for now? Yeah, I'll take a little break. And then I'll come back to the questions and I'll go to the chat and see what we're talking about. Uh-oh, where are we? Okay. What's going on? Jarlin says, you got the Zulu SCSI to SG for the EPS. It's so much quicker to low. Also, that's why you were asking. You were actually thinking about getting one. Yeah, SCSI is just sort of, it's the only, you know, way back in the day to actually make the most of storing multiple files on things. So if you're doing a lot in a sampler and you know, you just have a lot of file management, floppies would get to you at that point, you know. And now there's so many SCSI options that weren't available that are now. So yeah, man, good, congrats. It's a lot quicker. Yeah, it would be. Floppies take time. The barrier to entry for modular does seem a bit higher than with other types of gear. Not really, you know, like, I guess so, but yes, but no, you know, because, well, let's look at it this way. If you buy a MPC today, like when the mid-tier one, let's say you buy an MPC Live, dollar for dollar, that would get you a case and maybe three modules, you know, to start off with. But that, it's hard to say. Yeah, no. I think the barrier to entry, a lot of that, because I don't think a lot of people are hung up on the price of modular. I think they're hung up on the commitment of modular. I think when you get into modular, you have to commit. You can't experiment with modular unless you're buying like a small little system, like a grandmother or something like that. Then you could just play around and, you know, but if you're really going to commit to modular and actually by the time you're thinking of buying a case, that means you're in. And then you got to be like, okay, am I really going to be in like forever? You know what I mean? Or for a long time, you have to build the instrument and you're not going to do all of that if you're not really serious about it, you know? And I think that's, especially now, what kind of dictates the barrier to entry. Like, do you really want to go this? Not to mention the rumors that it's a rabbit hole, you know, when you go down there and you're never going to be able to get out of the module. Like, you really got to be about that life. And those who have made that choice, they don't seem to come out. You know what I mean? Like, everyone that I know that has been like, okay, I'm going modular, they're gone. And that's their instrument now. And I like that. But that's the sort of commitment it takes to actually go in modular. It seems like it's difficult to manage modular with another instrument. When I got in, I heard all the rumors and all that sort of thing. And all I can say is 5U for some reason has prevented me from even catching any type of modular bug. I guess I always kind of knew what I wanted my modular to be. And I had, you know, it just hasn't affected me the way it has others. But I do think that, you know, yeah, if you're really going to go hardcore modular, you have to actually consider it to be your instrument. There are relatively easy and very sophisticated modules. Yeah, like modular is easy. Modular, I never saw. I mean, modular isn't, the fact of it is it's not hard. Like, that's the fact. It may, you know, whether everything everyone that I've heard anyone who hasn't gotten into modular say from the outside looking in, they say that's too many wires. That looks complicated. How do you know what's going on? And it reminds me of the same way that people would speak about mixers before they would get in the studio. They'd be like, yo, there's too many knobs. Look at all those faders. And then you realize that all those faders are just clusters, you know, of modules stacked side by side. It's all the same thing replicated. Not to say that modular is the same thing, but it's really not hard. It's easier. If I give you the chance to actually see where the output of your oscillator is going into the into your filter, out of your filter, into your VCA, that's easy. Like, you can see it. Like, it's like kindergarten. And the reason why it looks complicated is because the wiring is on the outside that you're making as opposed to the inside. So it looks messy. Yeah, sure. Okay, I'll give you that. But it's not hard, you know? Especially when you consider the most of modular work, modular instruments are monophonic things. So it's not as difficult as it looks. I get it can look crazy, but it's the easiest thing ever. But yeah, I would say that as well, that, you know, I think what modular does, especially modular sampling and that sort of thing, it really would increase anyone's understanding. Like, if you had any sort of deficiency in understanding what's going on with synthesis or just electronic music in general, modular is like immediate school. Just getting any type of module, even like a Mother 32, would teach you way more than you ever would learn messing around with a pre-wired synth. Because you have to make everything happen or else nothing happens. But yeah, that's sort of my thoughts on the whole thing. Like, looking back at it now, like, you know, ModBap has been out for a good while now. And modular, there was its heyday. You know, I'd say like maybe 3-4 years ago, modular in general was fire hot. And it's dwindled down now. But I think that's a good thing because it's weeded out all the people that have jumped on the bandwagon and you know, it's sort of becoming more of a solidified sort of thing in the undercurrent. So when it emerges again, it's going to be like either you should have gone on a long time ago or you're going to want to get on now because you can see the structure in it. You could hear the good music in it now, you know, so it's all good. It's a great way to learn synthesis. Yeah, it's an amazing way. You know, when I heard people talk about that, I'd be like, you guys don't know what you're talking. You just don't know synthesis. You know, before I got into modular, people would say that and I'd be like, if you need a modular system to teach you about synthesis, then you just don't know about synthesis in the first place. And then I got one and I truly understood what what everyone was saying. It's not that you don't know synthesis before you get into this. It's that there are too many things that cannot be done in any pre-wired system. And when you start doing things by the act of you actually patching things, you then see how much you have locked off from you. It's like a closed door when you're dealing with a closed system. When you're dealing with something that was wired for you by a manufacturer, you can't create certain things. It's just not going to happen. They won't let you. And therefore, even though theoretically you know it's possible, you have no idea what it would sound like because you can't do it. In modular, you can do it. And you're like, holy smoke. And then when you do it, you're like, okay, well, what's actually happening here for this sound to happen? It's not magic. So what I'm hearing has to be explained a certain way. And your mind starts to go through the process of explaining and figuring out what's actually happening. And that's the synthesis. When you really understand exactly why a waveform is behaving away, because you've done something and you're seeing it happen right before your eyes, that can't happen in a number of scenarios when you're working with like a regular synth. It can't, you know? So that's where you learn stuff. You're like, oh my goodness, there's so many patches that you can do, even on a small system. My system's small, and I've made things that I've never been able to make on any synthesizer. It's just because you could do unorthodox stuff. You know, it just, I'll say this for people that are thinking about getting to modular, as my last statement and talk about modular, is that the great thing about it is you can't make a mistake in modular. Nothing's going to blow up. You know what I mean? You could patch anything into anything and nothing's going to go wrong. So it's an experimental playground. And often, more than not, you come across good stuff than you do bad stuff, I'd say. Still thinking of a reason to keep your SB404, you need to pay off Zounds. Oh, yeah. So, if you want my advice, Adrenaline, I would say, yes, do not operate in debt ever. So if you have gear, that's the only time I'd recommend selling gear. Like if you're in debt and you're unable to pay it off from your musical endeavors, possibly because you've gotten into debt through music, sell some stuff. Like don't ever operate out of debt. Like that's a waste of time, especially if something's not serving you. And I would say that something like an SB404, you could buy any old day. Let's say you wanted it back. You could just, like, SB404s aren't going nowhere. They never are. So sell it. Yes. That's the only time I'd recommend something. Don't deal with debt. Like be debt free all the time from music. My rule of business is if I can't pay for it outright, I just don't buy it. I don't do no credit. I don't do no nothing. If I can't pay for it, then I don't need it right now. You know. So if you need to pay off Zounds, pay off Zounds. You can't be creative in debt. That's a weight. You can't be, you know, creatively free and you owe somebody money. That's madness. PPV Median Synthesizer book is about the synthesis with Dofer modules. Oh, really? I don't know that book. Okay, thanks. What's going on, Amber? Giuseppe, what's going on, man? You good? Man, glad you tuned in. Good, good, good. In modular, no PSU to be serviced. Oh boy. What's going on, Serge? The control side of modular is a big question. Do you want to fire by MIDI or by CV in the modular? There's a whole slew of modules. Yeah, but there's choice there too. What's going on, Robert? You have the choice. It's not like it's, number one, you could do both, but it's not an either or thing or a question of, you know, it's not a hard decision to make, you know, and you could change your mind and you could, you know, I mean, it's options all day. But I think I would say, controlling over CV and controlling by MIDI will definitely give you two things. So I'd always encourage to go for both as you grow. Just for the feel of it alone. Dreadbox and Behringer is a good start. I would lean more towards Dreadbox than Behringer. But yes, I agree. Any small system is great. you know, any small system is amazing to start on. To me, like once you get your hand messing around with CV, that's the big thing for me. CV just feels different. And you know it when you're using it, you're like, this is not operating. You know, it's different. It's a different feel. You know, things behave different under CV control than anything else. And that alone brings a lot to your music. Like, I don't know anyone that just started off with a major wall of modular. I've never seen that. You know what I mean? Everyone starts off small because there's no way to figure out what you like, or even if you like it, you have to go sort of, you know, sort of piece by piece to figure out what's going on with you. And there's, at this point, I mean, the modular world is crazy, but, you know, to make hip hop with it is an amazing thing because now you have really a large amount of control over rhythm and placement. Like, there's no more grid. You know what I mean? Everything is free and you could play something literally anywhere and you could stretch it out and you could shift it and move it. Like, there's so much to do. But you wouldn't know that until you get it. You know what I mean? You just wouldn't know that unless you do it. It's such an amazing place to play, especially if you're dealing with rhythm. Hey, TDS, you watched on a video where you mimicked a SB1200 on a DAW. I did? Which one? I mean, I'm sure I did. So you're on the fence with purchasing the Isla S2400. Well, this is what I'm trying to say. There's much more going on with these machines. So, Adrenaline, this is what I was talking about overall. Like, when you are hung up on the sound of something, you cannot buy a piece of gear just for the sound. That's not enough. You're doing yourself a disservice and you're doing the instrument sort of a disrespectful outlook when you're just looking at it for the way it sounds. So even if you take the traditional sound of an SB1200, forget what I did. Like, there's a million plugins that are cheap that sort of emulate that sort of thing now. But you cannot go and buy a sound because that, my thoughts are running in front of me. What you just typed would be the issue that most people are having. And that's the first thing people say. They're like, well, if I can just get this sound in a plugin, what am I buying the box for? The answer is the box, whether it be the Isla S2400 or a traditional SB1200, has way, way, way more going on than the sound of it. Like, there's so many things going on in Isla S2400. The sound is just like the bass level to me, you know, and it helps to traditionally like the sound that a sampler makes, because that's going to help you, you know, with what you put in there. It's nice to hear something nice coming back, but that should be like the very, 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 like, that should just be something that may be like, oh yeah, it does sound nice, by the way, you know. And traditionally, samplers don't sound bad. So if you find something that actually sounds horrible, well, that's a big deal, you know. But generally, samplers don't sound that bad. But it's better to look at the actual functionality of it. And if I were to look at the SB1200, there's so much, like, what I value the SB1200 for is not the sound of it. The sound is amazing. I get that. Like, to me, like, that's bass level. The amount of other things that it does is what really makes it pull its weight in this studio. So the Isla 2400, in my view, the fact, like, you're forgetting the high sample rates that it has. You're forgetting that it runs at two separate sample rates. You're forgetting that it has an analog filter in there. You're forgetting that it has a looper in there. You're forgetting, you know, there's so much things that are going on with the S2400. In addition to its sound, that the sound is all the way down there. Like, that's what I would pay attention to when buying gear. You know, that's like the sort of advice I would give, because I'm saying what I'm saying because over the years, I've gotten so much of that where it's like, okay, well, this sounds like this. You don't buy any piece of gear based on the way it sounds. You will get disappointed, and there's too many rationalizations and excuses you can make. Not to call them excuses, but there's a lot of good arguments for why you shouldn't buy something when something else could sound similar. Will you ever be able to get a true authentic SB1200 sound out of a plugin? No. But who cares about that at this point? You know, nobody really does. So I would always say, like, look at the other things going on with the S2400, and that's what you base your decision on. And it will be just be clear. Like, when you just that stuff alone I've said is like strong reasons for the instrument in itself, in addition to its sound. And that stuff a DAW ain't going to really be able to help you with. You're not getting no analog filter in a DAW. It's just not happening, you know? But yeah, that's what I would say. If, to help you make your decision, because yes, if I can do it in a DAW, I've done a couple videos in it. That's why I was asking you which one. I can't, like, I've done a lot, but yeah, you can get pretty close. I've made the ASR 10 come close to, and you know, to the SB 1200. But in my mind, that's never been the reason why you buy an SB 1200. Like, I just would never do that, you know. The sound of a sampler just should be your taste or an extra icing on the cake. If you can keep it on that, will force you to look at what actually the sampler is good at. Now, on the flip side, the SB1200 is an incredibly basic sampler. And I suspect that a lot of people, because it's happened, who have bought an SB1200, like, oh man, this is too basic. Yeah. But the reason they didn't see it is because they were hung up on the other things, you know, the prestige of it. But when you really get one in your hand, you're like, oh my goodness, like, I'm bored now. Yeah, this 10 seconds ain't cutting it for me now. Yeah, you know, it's a little bit too big. You know what I mean? It, you know, that sort of stuff will start to creep in after a while. You can only blow up your ears. Exactly. Yeah. And that's true with any form of music. Like, you know, with modular, you can make mistakes just as I've had more audio mistakes in my DAW than I've ever done in modular. As a matter of fact, I don't think I've ever had an instance in modular where I've created a sound that's actually came out harmful. I could tell you I've done that in the DAW. I've done some things where if my volume was any higher, I'd probably be deaf. You know, that's never happened to me in modular. There's no reason why you can't have modular to play your MIDI samplers with CV to MIDI. With CV to MIDI modules. That's right. Yeah, that's absolutely right. I'm saying have it all. Yeah, I think CV to MIDI, oh geez, it's something that I've had to. CV to MIDI is a beast to get a hold of. Kenton, if that's what you're saying, like the rarity of it, Kenton is the only one of the, you know, there's modules that do it, but you know, Kenton is a company that the SB1200 is the company, is sorry, the box. That's what I use to convert MIDI to CV. Are you saying CV to MIDI? Now I'm confused. Right. Okay. Yeah, I follow you. Sorry. Mix myself up. All good. Hope you're good. Congrats on the new release. I admit you haven't checked out any of your music. You've been meaning to. Yeah, man. Well, I've did two releases last year. One is let's while we're here, the first one is Untraversed, which is here. All Dollar stuff I've been working on this year. The second release is Ameliorate. So I've did two last year and I'm working on one right now. The album that I'm working on right now is going to be probably a longer piece. Well, is a longer piece, and I'm just working into that. It's sort of like I wouldn't call it a new direction, but I'm trying to get back to my childlike state when I first started music. So a whole lot of things wrapped up in this album, as all albums are. You know, albums teach you a lot. Albums are like school for you. Albums are what gets you to the next step. Because you have to commit to them by way of releasing them. You can't go back and be like, "Oh, I didn't mean to do that." It's like you did mean to do it. So I'm trying to really learn a lot with this album that I'm making out now. But if any of you have not heard my music at all, I'd encourage you to go down to the daydreamsound.com and have yourself a listen. But yeah, man, been really busy on the Mirage Clone project. Oh yes, that's right, man. That's right. No, that's something good to spend your time doing. You like ALM? I do too. Talk about a company that sounds good. The Squid sample sounds absolutely beautiful. Yeah, ALM has done well, man. You know, Pamela's workout is one of the most popular sequencers out there, and from the get-go, you know, that you sort of, you know, ALM has done well, because you know, considering how new they came on the market hot, And they haven't, I don't know. To me, in the modular world, it's difficult for, I wouldn't say because it's so saturated with, in a good way, with a lot of modules, it's hard for a company to actually cut through and make that sort of imprint that ALM has done. And I would attribute most of that to Pam's workout, but they did good. But their sampler, the actual squid, beautiful. What popular songs are modular produced? You've only seen YouTube videos. You would like to hear something widespread from the Modbap world you didn't know. Okay, so you can check out. There's a comp. There's not anything. That's the thing. And the thing is, if it was, we wouldn't even know. But I would say for sure, you can check out Corey's Modbap label. But he has a compilation, a double LP, that has like him on it, upright, Ski Beats on it. It's a modular compilation of modular stuff, but most of the stuff is you're going to hear online. It's still underground. That's the thing about Modbap right now. It's still underground. Like maybe 30 years down the line, we'll be talking about it like, oh yeah, I remember when it was underground. But right now, the whole modular hip hop, this is it's on the same sort of stage as hip hop was in, let's say, 78 or something like that. It's super underground. And right now it's at the point where people are like, oh, it's not gonna last. Oh, I can't do it. Oh, it's like that. It hasn't took off yet, right? So right now you're looking at Modbap in its infant stages. Like we actually, you know what I mean? So in the history of it all, we attribute Voltage Controller Shiro is the godfather of it. He's the first person that we have on record and on video ever even doing this stuff. This was before it was even called hip hop. And this was in the early stages even Eurorack modular. Like even if we go back to those times, there wasn't that much even modular Eurorack out there. It's like a bunch of Dofer stuff. You know what I mean? Now there's a whole bunch, there's everybody under the sun. But that was even in the early days of Eurorack modular. So, you right now, are alive at a time when modular hip hop is very, very young, very, very young. So that question when, the question was like, why hasn't it take off? It's early days, but a lot of people are rejecting it. And it's going to take more momentum before it becomes cool to people. It's cool to me. But to most people, they just, you get the same comment all the time. People are like, nah, I'm not doing those wires. I'm not doing it. That will change. That will change. The music will change it. But I would say, yeah, to answer your question, if you go on, I can't remember the name of the compilation, but I'd say go to modbap.com because I know he has a link to his label or Beat People. Corey's Bandcamp page, and there's a on the Beat People label. That's it. There's a whole compilation on it, and I would say that's a good gateway into modular hip hop. And then also reach out to Shiro, Voltage Control. If you're not subscribed to him, you ought to be. But he's really like the godfather of it all. He's the earliest person that we know, for sure, doing the music, period. And he was doing it all by himself, So. It's early days. You're not going to get to live through a period like this ever again. Have you messed around with the Euclidean sequencing much? I have in Ableton. I've done it in Ableton because I have some Max for Live sequencers that done it. I'm not because I input my own stuff so much. To have something working on a Euclidean cycle, really, I haven't stuck with it enough. I can't say that I like it or dislike it. I just haven't touched it up enough. And what I'm hoping for, to be fair with you all about it all, is I can sense that gonna that sort of feature is gonna creep up in the Electron stuff real soon. in the Octatrack, if not in an update in the newer stuff. And that's what I'm waiting for. Like when it drops in there, it'll be too hard for me to ignore. So I'll have to be able to mess around with it in an environment that I'm comfortable with. And that's where I'm really kind of looking forward to really dealing with any type of sort of sequencing things like that. You like the Isla and SB1200 do something to the transients, and the hard drum sounds better than anything else you've heard drum wise. Well, that's just the way they interpret stuff. But I mean, again, those are things you can create with your own attack curves. As a matter of fact, on NTSC PAL, I was really thinking of doing a video about that. My next video, I think I wanted to make a video where I play a drum sound coming out of the SB1200, and I literally want to remake the same drum. Well, we'll sample the same drum sound into the Octatrack or any sampler and just sort of play around with the envelopes till they sound just as snappy. You know what I mean? Because you could control the sound at that point. While it's a favorable thing and it's less work for you to do, again, that's not really the reason why I would go for these instruments. Like there's a lot more going on. The 24 parts per quarter note grid of the SB1200 sequencer, that's hard to find anywhere. And that's very, very valuable because it makes your music, like that's not something you could just get somewhere else. Like it doesn't work like that anywhere else. You know what I mean? Other than a few phrases, you know, those of you who know. But, you know, that sort of thing to me is way more valuable than any of these things. Like when we're talking about sound at this point in day, you can make anything you want to have. And the only limitation is your understanding of how to really treat sound. It's very advantageous to have a sampler that just is on its best behavior, like the SB1200 when you touch it. But I'm not buying a piece of gear for that. No, it's going to have so much going on. So again, like I'd really say, like, look at the actual features, because I guarantee you what's going to happen is you're going to get bored. It's not, you're going to get used to it and you're going to be like, what else does this machine have? And luckily, I think something like the Isla would have something else for you, like plenty of things for you to enjoy, as well as the SB1200. But if it doesn't, you're going to be pissed off. And then you're going to be like, why did I buy this? Because I'm not impressed with the sound anymore. You know, it will happen. You know, if you started off on an SB1200, you wouldn't even be, you'd be like, what are you talking about? It has a sound. I don't know. Like, it's not until you start comparing stuff to other samplers when you realize what you actually have in your hands. I had no idea what my EPS 16 plus sounded like. It didn't sound like anything to me until I got in the DAW. And then I was like, oh my goodness, let me go back, you know, but you don't know. So if, and I'm just saying that to say you get used to it, there has to be more in a sampler that you're working with every day to appreciate, you know, for any long-term piece like that. Do I know if you can achieve the high pass filters on the Rossum SP2? I would imagine so. The reissues look like they're pretty much like a SP1200 with just additions onto it. I don't think it behaves differently in that way. So I think the way it achieves its access to the filter is the same. I don't know. I could never tell you because I don't own the new ones. And it's not a high pass filter. It's just cancellation that's going on. But I at first brush, just looking at it, it looks like it. Like I would be more inclined to say yes than no. I'll never know for sure. But I really would have a hard time thinking that it doesn't. Because, yeah, it doesn't look like there's anything like, it doesn't look like the new reissues are some sort of overhaul in the circuitry. It looks like it's a SB1200 with added, it almost, think of the, you know, I look at the new Rossum Electro reissues like circuit bent SB1200s. It looks like a SB1200 that somebody cracked open, in this case, Dave Rossum, and said, I'm going to add this and I'm going to add this. But it doesn't look like he built it from the ground up. It looks like an authentic SB1200 that's had stuff added to it more than a restructured instrument housed in a traditional SP1200 box. Because it sounds like an SP1200 to me. It, from what I hear online, it behaves like it. I haven't heard anything from those new boxes that are like, oh, that's like, yes, there's differences, you know what I mean? But it's not, yeah, not enough to make me think that if you take a balanced cable and stick it in the back, maybe I'll just take a look at the manual one day. That will answer the question right away, but I just don't know. Filtered out high pass filter. Yeah, I know what you meant. Sorry, y'all, if I'm behind the chat. Oh my goodness, maybe I am behind the chat. Just trying to take your drums to the pinnacle, and there could be an argument for can the gear be part of the inspiration process because you've lost all interest in working in the DAW. That's cool. I'm just telling you, gear ain't going to do that for you. Like, you're going to have, like, I'm saying your bestest and cheapest. The reason why I'm sort of trying to point at you is that don't forget you have a slew of vintage samplers in your studio right now. So my ultimate argument for not buying anything in your case, Adrenaline, is if you can't get done what you have with what you have right now, nothing you buy is going to satisfy you. You know what I mean? I think the issue with that you're having with your drums is that you just need to work on your drums. And I don't get me wrong, the SP1200 would help specifically, or the S2400 would help. But I think the bigger issue that you're running into is that you just got to put in the time to get the sound you're looking for and realize that that type of thing doesn't happen overnight. So in the meantime, you make music and your sound comes to you. That's the way it works with everybody. You don't wake up overnight and just make like a masterpiece. You don't reach your pinnacle overnight. And let's say you do. Well, where are you going to go after that? You know what I mean? There's people who do that. There's people that hit their magnum opus right away, but they don't tend to have a very lasting career after that because they just sort of shot their load and that's it. So realize that this is a growing process, but focus more on your actual interaction with the equipment you have or any equipment. It's just equipment. You know what I mean? Don't put so much stock into it is what I'm saying. Put stock into your actual work with it and you will grow. If I can make the Octatrack sound good with nothing, I don't run it into anything and I can make it tear your head off if I need it to. I mean, of course, there's enough going in there, but it's the fact that, you know, we all work on these things. So that would just, you know, that's what I would do. If you're not inspired with a DAW, then don't use the DAW. You know what I mean? Don't worry about it. And realize this too, now that you're writing that, that none of this gear is here to inspire you. Like, that's not his job. Inspiration comes from many places. But it just sounds like in general, it's common, but it sounds like you're putting so much expectation. You know, you're projecting so much onto this gear. That's not the gear's job. You know what I mean? If you need inspiration, look somewhere else. You know what I mean? This is just it's just an environment that you work in. You know what I mean? That presents a group of tools where you can get any specific task done in the musical realm. That's it. Now, it may be enjoyable for you to work in, and you may have a good time, you know, in the DAW or in the hardware, wherever you work, but its job isn't to inspire you. I don't get my inspiration from none of this gear, and I like everything I have in this studio, but I do not look at it as inspiration at all. The main limitation of the SP1200 for sampling of faster clips down sampled to normal speed, which added a lot of SP1200 grunging character. Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah. Is the workflow of the S2400 same? No, they're not even the same machine at this point. The SP12, no. No, the SP1200 is the basic of the basic of the basic. Like, it's the easiest sampler in the world, and that's what makes it fun to use. It's so easy, and it's so, when I say easy and basic, I'm not saying it as an insult. It's so intuitive that it's just like you kind of can't go wrong on it. It's just like every, if you think something should be in a certain place or should happen a certain way, it's because it already does, is why I call it, like, that's what I mean by basic. But it is basic in the truest sense, is in the sense that there's not that much going on in the SP1200. It's not a hard thing to learn. It's like the easiest sampler in the world. It's easy, especially compared to anything you are using today. Now, if you look at an S2400, I don't consider any sampler hard, but it has a lot going in, especially now. The S2400 is not the same S2400 of 2 years ago. Like, Brad has added so much into it, where if you're looking at it just for instrument to instrument, the SP1200 cannot stand in the same room as the S2400 when it comes to actual features. Like, the S2400 is a completely different thing. And yes, I understand that, you can look at the S2400 as a clone or a successor or a reimagination of what the SP1200 would be. They are not the same thing. I don't care what you think you're looking at, or what, they're not the same at all. Even though they have the same, I get it. I get all that. But if you're looking at one instrument and another, they are not interchangeable at all. If you had an S2400 and I took that away from you and gave you an SP1200 and said, do the same thing you do on the S2400, you'd be pissed at me. You'd be like, give me my S2400 back. I'm not working on this SP1200. No. You know what I mean? They're not the same. Two different machines, completely generation years of decades apart from each other. Two different types of technology. I wouldn't look at them as the same thing. The safest way to go, even though you'll get a lot of similarities in the tonal character, it almost is like it stops there. And the interface, obviously, with the faders. What's going on, Peter? Man, you straight? Good to see you, man. Alessandro Cortini music has some great modular parts, and it's also Buchla, which is not common used for structured music, except by Ciani and Subotnick. Yeah, I mean, modular music has been around since the beginning, of synthesis, I would imagine. It's modular music is well established. Modular hip hop is very, very early, and it's still growing. Like, there's way more to go, way more to go. Like, you can just hear it. I could just hear it because, yeah, it hasn't even scratched the surface. Like, there's light years to go in the genre itself, and that's a good thing. You never want to start a genre where you're like, okay, I could see the end. You know what I mean? So that when I'm talking about modular, I'm speaking about it in that context based on the question we were talking about earlier on. But yeah, Richard Devine just got himself a Buchla system. Junkie XL got himself a Buchla system. Like, Buchla's the thing to get into now. Like, that's my Buchla Surge. There's enough Surge clones to get into that now. But yeah, I agree with you in that I think the Surge and the Buchla stuff, I don't know if it's the right word to say, but they just sound more musical, you know what I mean? And I think from the inception they were meant to sound that way, but they just come across more musical. I don't know how to say it. It seems like they are almost the same with more options and features. You hear the main complaint is too much menu diving on the Isla. I can see that as a complaint. That's because it's grown, I would say. Like, it's grown. I don't think, I don't know. I've never found menu diving as a problem, but I can understand and see why it would be a problem for many, and I get it. But yeah, I you cannot just tell it. I could only speak from what the SP1200 is. The SP1200 is, it's, I like to speak on it just to clear a lot of the myth that people have about it. When I tell you it's an easy, 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 easy instrument, it's easy. You can learn how to be up and running on SB1200 in well less than an hour. Half an hour. I could give you an SB1200, and from the minute you turn it on, you'll have a beat done in a half an hour. That's how easy it is to get up and running, because it's like, it's all there. And that's without reading anything. I could just put one in front of you and be like, okay, use this. And you'll have it going in a half an hour. Oh, geez, sorry, man. Yeah, sorry, right? Geez, how could I omit Ali? Yeah, there's so many out there, man. Like, yeah, Ali's a beast, like a mega beast. He's one of the, just to speak on Ali for a moment, when you talk about somebody that is like, Ali's like, he's like a quick learner. Ali's the type of person you can give him something and he'll just be like, he'll just do more than somebody else would at the same point. Like Ali is one of those artists that he pretty much did. Ali's one of those artists, like contrary to what I said earlier, he could and for the most part he has started with a full rack, like from the get-go. Like I don't remember Ali starting with like a couple modules. It's like one day he literally had a couple modules, and then the next day he had like a Pittsburgh modular full out case full of modulars, and the music sounded like he was making, like it sounded like he was using modular. He sounded seasoned right out the gate. He didn't sound like, okay, I just started. Like he just sounded pro, like just from the get go. Euclidean sequencers is great for percussion, I'd imagine. There's definitely more menu diving with the Isla 2400, but there's shortcuts. Yeah, menu diving is just something, I think when you like your instrument, I think, you know, when we speak about menu diving, I think menu diving becomes a problem when you just don't like the instrument in the first place. When like when you put up with the instrument, then menu diving becomes a problem. Like if I didn't like the Octatrack, I would say it's menu diving. But because I like it, I literally know where every menu is. And even though I got a dive, as you would classify it, I don't even feel it because I like it. Now, if I did not like it, I'd be like, yeah, there's too much going on in here and nothing's labeled. I have to remember everything. Like I wouldn't put up with it, you know? So I think like whenever like you think about something, just in like when you're searching out a piece of gear, if it's menu diving, I wouldn't put so much weight on to that. If you actually get on with the instrument, the menu diving ain't really going to bug you that much. If the instrument has only a little bit of stuff that you like, then the menu diving is going to become like a big sore thumb. You're going to be like, okay, yeah, this instrument ain't the hottest and I got to dive to find everything. Forget it. You know, it tips the scales real quick. Oh yeah. But that's what I said, Adrenaline. Like, honestly, like if I could give you some advice, man, don't buy nothing. I don't think you need anything. You have an MPC. You have a drum machine already. Buying another drum machine ain't going to make your day better. It's just going to make it more confusing for you to get some music done. I just think you're at a point in your walk right now where I could literally, it's almost like I'm seeing like that like you're creating avenues to walk down other than the main avenue that you should be walking down. And the main avenue means that you should be making music and there's all these side roads that you want to take and they all have gear at the end of them. Like that's not going to help you. That's just going to distract you. You have a studio full of some choice gear. Like that's what you're supposed to be working on. It's only gear. Like it's just, like, it's really ain't that important. Like the music's really going to come from you and that's going to become from your connection to actually making the music. That's the muscle you got to work. I would say something different to you if your gear was kind of like, you know, if you had like the like that Yamaha Seek and you had if you just had toy gear, but none of your gear is like joke gear, so that's not the issue. You're already at a standard where you're able to get some work done, like you have, like, you can get it done, you know? And you have a good mix of eras too. You literally have 80s gear, you have 90s gear, you have current gear. Like, you have the full palette. So really, to me, it's about getting work done. It seems like you're apprehensive to actually get in there because there's no fun in that. Like, it's school time for you is all I can see. And that's how you're going to take your music to the next level. It's actually doing it. Because there's never going to be a time, like, there's always going to be better gear there. There's always going to be something that sounds better. There's drum machines that sound better than an SB1200. Oh no, don't let this chat jump on me. Sorry, guys. Oh, I know I'm behind. Holy smoke. Okay, let me catch up. Let me really try and catch up. I apologize. You think the Electron might add it? I do think so. Yeah, I do think they'd do that. I think that's a natural progression. Like, look, it's not like it's already a step sequencer. There's nothing difficult about, oh, should I say Euclidean? Yeah, I do think so. I don't think it's a big deal to add, like, actual more sequencing options or something akin to a Euclidean sort of format into the Octatrack. Right now, it may not be full blown just because, you know, of the linearity of it all, but on a new Octatrack, I don't see that as a big deal. Which vintage sampler has the snappiest envelopes, in my opinion? Holy smoke, snappiest. I would say the snappiest envelope that I've heard just out the box is the SB1200. It's just like, but it's a drum machine. But you have no control over the envelope. So the snappiest, geez, there's not that many snappy samplers. That's a good question. Because now you have me comparing it to modular, and that's like an unfair thing to do. Oh, man. Give me a second. Let me look around the room. That's a tough thing to say. Because I really don't regard any sampler as being incredibly snappy. And it's hard for me right now to make to really not draw the comparison. I can't answer that question. That's a good question. I don't have an answer for you. I really don't. Adrenaline, if I were you, I'd focus on mastering the EPS, master the... Yeah, man. I like any of the gear you have, I would say that. I just see buying gear as a common thing that everybody does. Everybody does that, and there's a reason why they do it. It's like gambling. It's like looking at the grass at the other... You know, looking at the grass being greener on the other side of the fence. It's like you have gear already. If you're not getting the sound you want... Not even close to it, or not even seeing a way to, you know what I mean? That's a you problem. That's not the gear. Hey TDS, what mixer interface do you track with? I just use this Mackie. I've had this Mackie since the beginning. Well, not the beginning, but since like 2000, and I've not given it up yet. My recording process is really, really super, super basic. But it's a Mackie 1202 Pro, the last good one, I think. I don't know what they're doing now. I don't know how much better their preamps and stuff have been. But it's just, there's nothing special about the mixer. It doesn't have any particular wonderful sound to it. It's pretty basic. There's a guy in Finland in Sweden that makes clones of the 4X memory expander. So I hear. Yeah. Oh, I know. Yeah, I know Zen Circuits. Yeah. For the EPS Classic. That's right. Yeah. Sometimes it's a good... Oh, guys, I'm so behind. Bloody hell. Sorry, excuse me. Sometimes it's good to even ignore advice and follow your gut. You're right about that. You like learning the interfaces and talking about that perspective into other spaces. Yeah, that's true. It's been 9 years yesterday since Bruce Crocker passed away. I know. That is nuts. What's going on, Jamie? Exactly. The S2400 is its own thing at this point. Like it's way different. And I know when it came out, like we were all like, that's all we knew. We're like, okay, this is going to be like a clone. But it really has not been a clone, even from like those days. It didn't, it's definitely not a clone. It has the capability of giving you that grit sound like an SP1200. Oh man. What is the second easiest, most basic sampler next to the SP1200 you would say? Oh gosh, I don't know. Like popular stuff? MPCs. MPCs are pretty, I mean, yeah. Anything that's really, really popular and stood the test of time, it's there because it's easy. So I would say the thing that jumps out at me, I would say the MPC is the next easiest thing that I've ever touched that I've been like, holy smoke, like this thing just like whatever you think something should be doing, it's just intuitive and easy to use. What's going on, JC? I appreciate this. You have talking the fear out of modular for me. You only have a Motif 8 classic. Oh, he said I only. I just have an amazing keyboard. Yeah, anyway, classic and reshoot SP1200 and SP1200. You're giving me a fresh new perspective. Yeah, I wouldn't say jump into modular just to jump into it, but there's nothing to be afraid of. It's way easier than any gear you're using now. Like that's like modular is nothing to be afraid of at all. Now you're curious what a digital sampler with a snappy analog filter with a snappy analog ADSR would sound like. Well, that's the thing, right? That's why I like things like the Waldorf Quantum, because then you're getting into that sort of territory where you get to pass anything that has an analog filter component to it, because you can swap that out for a VCA at that point. Like to me, a analog filter can be a VCA or any sort of attenuation at that point if you're using a low pass. Then you get into that territory. So if you're talking about it on that level, to me, any of the samplers that have an analog component to it, like the Mirage, even the S950 can get snappy. The envelopes just aren't really super fast. That's what I mean. Like anytime I'm thinking of fast, I start thinking of what happens in modular, and that stuff is like blazing fast. Like stuff is just like actually like low pass gate like. Maybe that's unfair of what I'm doing because yeah, it's the way I'm thinking of it. Sorry, now that we're talking about it. Because when you said snappy sort of envelopes, I'm thinking low pass gate. And this is what I mean. Like we should have low pass gate stuff in a sampler. So when I'm thinking of like a low pass gate sort of pluck, or like that sort of bukla, just like bukla bongo sorts of sound, like that stuff is just like blazing fast, super sharp. You're not no sampler does that. I don't have anything like that. But for a fast sort of envelope, I don't know. That's been my problem with samplers over the years. Like stuff, and that's how you get stuff that actually like just sort of knocks your head off when stuff is just like boom, or even if it gets up there. Now on the Insonic stuff, because there's so many points in an envelope, you can shape stuff to be hitting real hard. But the envelopes aren't terribly fast. You know what I mean? Maybe that's what I'm saying. Sorry, yeah. My mind went somewhere different as soon as you said snappy. Like I just went to low pass gate mode, and you're not going to get that in any sampler today. But I would say that stuff like the Waldorf Quantum, when you're getting modern analog stereo filters, geez, I wonder if the VC, anyway, yeah, and you can, you know, you'd be able to get some pretty fast stuff out of that. You use Yamaha. Oh my goodness. And now that we're on Yamaha for a second, like the FM stuff coming out of the montage. Oh my goodness. Talking about plucky sounds, like the whatever they got going on in there, you can get some serious, you know, attack out of that. He said, Lewis, the workflow is one of my favorite on the EPS. You got the Live 2 mastered and you're getting really fast on the EPS, so I'm not on the fence anymore. You're not getting the IHA. Y'all are right. Yeah, man. Like anytime you sit down and you're like, should I get this? I don't know. In my experience, it's because you're bored or you're just excited for the moment, and it's best to let that sort of thing pass. But if you, here's the defining factor. If you don't have enough evidence to get something, then don't get it. And you could substitute evidence for work. So if you're working and you don't haven't made any product, meaning songs that are bringing you in money or bringing you any type of positive inclination towards you upgrading your studio, it's not time to upgrade your studio. It's time to work. You know what I mean? That's the way I look at it. Your studio really should pay for itself, like its endeavors that you're doing, if you're talking business anyway, and I think you are. If your work, if you're doing something, and by all things equal, your studio is set up like you have a good studio already, if you're working and that work isn't generating any evidence, any music, anything to show you that you need to upgrade, you don't need to upgrade. You just need to work. And that's not cool. It doesn't feel nice. It's very boring. It's antagonizing. It's just not, it's the part of the game that's not fun. You don't get to bop your head in your studio. There's no celebration when you're working. It's just straight up work. It's not as exciting as going to sounds and pressing by. There's no adrenaline rush. There's nothing. It's just straight up, you know. So I would always say that. Chase, anyone, do you know of the name of the 8-bit French drum machine sampler? No, I don't know. Is it something new? I don't know. You run your S1200 through the Yamaha analog, two analog mixers. Oh, I got you. You've seen the Isla for 900 and got excited. Yeah, don't do that. I knew it. I didn't even read your comment. That's usually what happens. It's usually you see something and you get hyped for the moment. You got to let that pass. That doesn't escape anybody. Seeing gear for like, oh my goodness, I could pick that up right now price is going to make you want to grab something, but it's not a good idea. It's not economically sound. It doesn't help you get any better. What gets you better is actually working. That's how you get better. That's the only, you can't learn no other way than actually making something and finishing it and getting, seeing how it does. You haven't really looked deep into modular stuff yet, but you know there are various sampler modules. Is there any in particular that stand out doing something really interesting and different? Yeah, I like my top three, I'll give you my top samplers right now. I like the Percussa. I like the ERM, ERM 301. I like, obviously, the Assimilator. You know, these are like my top three. And then there's a whole bunch of little things that I like. I always say I like the Radio Music thing. It's just too simple. It's amazing. There's the 4MS sampler. The one they came out with last year is just so easy. And you can come up with some crazy stuff through modulation. I like that. I like the Erica Synths, their little module they have. And then there's a whole lot of other stuff I like. I said I like the ALM. I like the way it sounds. It's not particularly something that I would like in my rack if I had to buy it, but I like the way it sounds. What else is there that I like? There's so many. The Harvestman. It's not. I always want to call it the Harvestman, but it's the new... that company. IML or IME, whatever. It's called the Harvestman. It's not called that now, but if you look up Harvestman, you'll see what I'm talking about. I like that. Of course, the Phonogene, that's now the Morphogene. I like that. What else is there? There's so many. Oh, we smoke. You can look at clouds, you know. I don't, you know, clouds, you can look at it as sort of like a granular sort of control sampler. You can't go wrong with clouds. And there's enough remakes of it. I like that. I can go on and on. Like, there's a lot. But those are sort of like my rattle off the brain list that I like, you know. Bought your Isla for less than 1K on the pre-order. Best purchase decision you've made. Oh, yeah. Yeah, that price, when he was selling it for $849, I was like, this is incredible. And people, if I recall correctly, people were like, oh, I'll wait and see type thing. And I was just like, if you're not going to buy this for $849, and I get, like, you know, you never know what you're walking into. But looking back at that now, you know, if you really wanted one and you didn't get it, then you should be kicking yourself if you actually passed up on that price. But yeah, you did good. You did good getting it for the 1K pre-order. Best purchase decision you may ever have made, but it has problems. You have the screen burn-in for one. The unit crashes a lot. Oh, really? These are the things you got to deal with. Is the Octatrack good as a first hardware sample? No, I wouldn't get it if I were you. As a first sample, I wouldn't touch an Octatrack. Unless you truly resonate with it. Not to say the Octatrack is hard. I'm just saying, like, what just the general word on the street is. Most people that I know do not tolerate an Octatrack well. And if that was your first sampler, you'd probably be upset. I honestly think that for a first sampler, you should at this point start with a DAW. My two, in hardware form, if you want to consider that, I still say something along the lines of Native Instruments, like a machine type thing, or a MPC type thing. Why? Because you can't go wrong with it. There's tons of support. They're easy to use. They're popular for a reason. It's because they're very user-friendly. So you will, you know what I mean? You'll learn your way around. And while they're drum machines, you'll learn your way around. You know what I mean? They kind of have the basics covered. The Octatrack is a little more... It's a little bit more taxing on your on what it expects from you to know and understand about it. And unless you have the patience to put time into it, I would love to say it should be your first sampler, but I just, my common sense goes against it. But I would love to say that, but I wouldn't do that. I'm going to upgrade your S3000, though. You found a pro filter board for it. Oh, yeah, that's a good thing to do for a board, FX board, too. Then you're done buying crap. Yeah, man, stop buying. It's an addiction. You know, that's really what it is, you know. And just remember, you know, you already know. Oh, versus more easy stuff like an MPC or direct to modular. You know, Amber, if your tolerance level, like, that's the thing. Like, you know yourself, if you really look at modular and you're like, yo, that clicks with me, that's a pretty good sign. Because generally, modular doesn't call out to people like that. You know what I mean? Like, modular sort of is kind of like, most people generally approach it with caution. If you're looking at modular and being like, yes, this is kind of what I've been missing, you may want to look into it. Like, at least go into a music store and play with one and see what's going on. And that would let you know right away. So it's hard to say, you know, you have to give yourself a little bit of, you know, you know better than me. But just generally speaking, I would say if you're getting into sampling for the first time, go with something that's sort of like easy and has all the things in the right spot in a general sense. And MPCs are kind of like that. But honestly, I would start in a computer because it's free. It's easy. You know what I mean? There's little strain on commitment that way. And that way, if you don't like it, you could be like, oh, well, it didn't cost me anything. You remember back in Isla 2400 was just on the market. The dude was in one of your live chats. He said he was going to send you one. Do you remember that? Yeah, I do. Yeah, you remember that? Yeah, man. Brad's a good dude, man. And he meant it. He wasn't lying. I didn't take him up on his offer. And that's my problem. I have a hard time accepting things. Because of that. Like, I literally, when I say like I really don't want gear in this studio, it's not because I don't appreciate more stuff. It's that gear, like anything else, it can distract you. And right now I've got my studio in a place where I can work and I know this stuff, and taking time to learn stuff or put my attention different way. Like, look how long it's taking me to get this computer up and running. That's how I am. If I got a new piece of gear, I would literally, it would be a distraction for me. So you saw a little bit of that with you, but yeah, that was a while ago. That was like 2 years ago. But Brad, you know, Brad's done good with the SP1200, man, or the S2400. TDS, have you tried it? No. I haven't even put my hands on one, never saw one. The last time I considered buying one, it was for like $4,500. And it was for sale, and I just didn't pull the trigger. This must have been, geez, 6 or 7 years ago. And that's the last time I saw one for sale. You don't see those ones for, you don't see Studio 440s on sale just for fun. Like, there's literally a handful of those in existence. And when they come up, you can buy. And I saw the one I saw, you know, I just couldn't, you know, it would just be a collection piece. And I would love to see one in action in real life, but I don't have enough interest in that sort of thing anymore to buy one. But, and that's the only, like, how are you gonna, unless you know somebody with one. If you want to check out the rack, you're going to hunt for expander of the guy on Facebook. Oh, I see. Yeah, yeah. Brad was in your chat. What's going on, Jordan? Yes, he was. Damn you. Yeah, that's the I understand, Jordan. People really don't get me. I'm coming to understand that. Like, I say things and people really don't like, I shouldn't say people, but it's like, I'm not like that. Like, when I tell you I don't look at gear that way, I really don't. I know it may seem like I'm just saying that like it's not true, but if you, I'm the type of person where you say, if you said, look, man, I got a Moog One for you, I would say no. Not because I don't appreciate, and it seems rude too, like I not to say I feel bad about it, but I just, like, I know what it means for me. And no, is the answer no. And that's why I don't have gas. Like, I look at gear for what it is. To me, my goal in life, one of them, is to just be an artist. My musical ambitions are so simple. I just want to be, I've done everything in my life. I've sort of pushed myself towards a point by hook or by crook and through all types of sacrifice just to be able to do music. That's all I want to do. Everything else musically ain't really on the same level as that aspiration. And as long as I'm able to get up and make music, and the icing of the cake of it is to be able to put it out there and have people actually listen to it, well, that's beyond and beyond anything I've ever hoped for, and that's actually happened. So career wise I'm over the moon right now. Gear is like on like the, in the basement level of that right now. Gear doesn't, so when it comes to gear, I could talk about gear all day, but it's not on the same sort of level as I see it now. When I got online, I see that a lot of people don't look at gear that way. Like, they really, really just like gear, and music is something they don't value that much. And I'm becoming accustomed to that outlook. To me, it's the inverse, you know? So when you see things like that happen, that's just how I am. Every new bit of gear tends to give you as much problems as opportunity. You're right about that. It's so true. It's so true. It's funny though. It really is. Like there's stuff that I learned even about the Octatrack, you know. I still crack open the manual. Like there's so many things to learn about it. And it's like just this morning I was thinking about something with the ASR-10, well the InSonic Trilogy that I've never really thought about before. And I'm like, man, I gotta make a video about that and try it because I'll forget. You know, there's always so much to learn that there's no room for more gear. I don't have that type of brain capacity. I just don't got it like that yet, you know? So I could only make, you know, it's that's what it is. Thanks. You like a lot of semi-modular stuff, working on the Moog Granny for that's enough, yeah. Years, but few whole cable but fair the whole cable stuff like you already say. Yeah, it's not hard. It's super smart to restrain oneself by buying stuff. It just keeps you from making music with what you got. You learned the hard way. Yeah, it doesn't go anywhere. Like, yeah, I don't suffer that, you know. I don't suffer that issue, you know. I don't think I've never, like, I don't think in general I've ever even had a gas problem in comparison to what I've seen online. Like, what I consider gas is like not even worth discussion compared to what I've seen online. And that's why I say, like, what I see online is literal, like, addiction problems. Like, you can't control yourself. Like, it's like you, if you don't buy something, you get upset. Like, that doesn't, to me, I'm just like, oh, you know what? I like that. So I'll plan, you know, I'll make room for it in my studio. But that whole thought process may take like 5 years before I'm actually ready to pull the trigger. Because I think about it. I think about, like, you know, okay, is this really going to be just something that's going to stop me? Or can I just put this into studio and it's actually going to help me? There's not been very much gear that I can say has done that for me. And there's definitely not that much gear out today that would ever even come close to doing that for me. Like, just wouldn't do it. In comparison to what I already have, anyway. That's what you're saying. You have all you need at this point, but your acquisition of the Isla is what made this true. Yeah, no, it's an amazing piece of gear. That's why I talk about it a lot. Yeah, it's a dope. It was dope from the beginning. Like, it was never... Yeah, man. Anyway, y'all know what I think about it. Gas has taught you how weak your character was, but you grew out of it. It's not that, man. Like, everybody has their thing. I'm not here talking, like, none of this stuff is above me. I got my problems in life in other areas of life. It's just that when it comes to gear, it just doesn't have that way with me. You know, we all have our things. I wouldn't consider that weak. That's just something that's got you. That's it, you know. And then you realize it by your actions, you know. But that's the only way you'd be able to work on it, you know, is if you're faced with it and you're like, holy smoke, like I really, really got a problem here. Otherwise, you wouldn't know, you know. I wouldn't call that weakness. I definitely wouldn't call that weakness. I would call that, you know, because what most people do is they ignore it. Most people see a problem. They're like, no, I don't have a problem. Like, no, I don't have any problem. If you see something and you're like, yo, this is, you know, this is a problem for me, that acknowledgement is a big step. All right, now question time. Where did we leave off? Oh my goodness, I got so many questions. Okay, next question is, this is not so much of a sampler question, but I always like to include the ESQ-1 as an honorary sampler just because of its architecture. But this is, actually, the video is called A Synth That Acts Like a Sampler. And Miles asks, could you make it sound like a piano, like a grand piano? And that's the ESQ-1 by InSonic. I would say no. I'm pretty sure with enough synthesis, you can get it to sound pretty, like it has a couple, you can make a piano patch easy, but grand piano, nah. I haven't heard anybody with just pure synthesis make a grand piano sound, but you can get like you can do some damage synthesis wise on the ESQ-1 for sure. It has the tools in there to do some good stuff, but just something sounding like what we know a grand piano to sound like, no way. That would just be, you know, that'd be too much for the little ESQ-1. But it does sound amazing. So just you know, if any of you wonder why I like the ESQ-1 so much, 8-bit native samples, analog Curtis filter, in crazy envelopes, negative envelopes. Envelopes go positive and negative, loopable envelopes, crazy modulation. Need I go on? AM synthesis, hard sync. It's just amazing sort of 80s hybrid. It's just so nice, you know. And it sounds crazy gritty. It's nasty. But it's a wonderful, wonderful cheap synth that good stuff. Next question. What I learned experimenting with the Elonic and Sonic Mirage loop points. Madhouse asks, hi, is the Mirage DMS worth getting? You have an ASR10 and don't have the space for the keyboard Mirage as well. I think so. I'm using the rack now more than anything because I, you know, it's in my rack space. I think if you're one to tolerate rack gear well, there's incredible benefits in using the rack version. I don't think you even feel too much of a difference at all. You know, the Mirage rack is pretty much a Mirage. Next question is, this is from my early days of YouTube. As you can see, is my picture. This is when you couldn't choose a thumbnail. And I haven't changed it till this day. This is like 2007 YouTube or 2009 YouTube. Anyway, Almighty Equilax asks, was the bit crush on your voice on purpose? Probably a dumb question. You don't think you do anything accidentally. So this video is so old, from the earliest days of YouTube, when I was working, and at work I got this camera to take pictures of, you know, things I had to do on my job site. It was just a cheap little camera, but the mic in it was this crappy mic. It's the only thing I had to shoot video at the time. I didn't have anything like this was before the days when your phone could like actually record video well. At least mine couldn't. Like I had like an old, probably BlackBerry at the time. So this was before video days, like where we are now, where you just did video with your phone. You literally had to have an actual camera in these days. So that's what I used to make my earliest YouTube videos on. And this is one of them. So because of that, all my earlier like EPS 16 plus videos, like the sampler sounded way more grittier than it was because it was coming through that mic, which was like this really, I mean, the mic sounds crazy. Like you could record audio on that mic and it sounds like a sampler. But everyone used to be like, oh my goodness, like your voice sounds like a sampler. Everything you record sounds like an old dirty sampler. It's because of the mic on the cheap camera. It's just like a really cheap camera. So he was asking like, was it on purpose? No, it was all that I always had. And I was using my work materials to make YouTube videos. You know, that was in the early days of YouTube when I was just starting out. But that's the answer to the question. Next question. Oh, yes. This is from my SCSI talk and post review of the EPS 16 Plus. Breaks Berlin asked, he says, hello, I have a question regarding this topic. I have an EPS 16 Plus and SCSI port, and there is a RAM expansion connected, but the expansion does not have the possibility to connect another SCSI device like a zip drive. How is this fixed? Do you have to search for another version of the RAM expansion board? Thanks. This is an amazing question because this is, oh my goodness, this requires some backstory. So if you've bought an Insonic sampler, either an EPS 16 Plus or EPS Classic, the actual EPS expansion pack that you put on the back, you have to buy. So you stick that in the back of the EPS or the EPS 16 Plus, right? That's your expansion. That expansion pack is also the SCSI port, but you have to literally open it up and install the SCSI port manually. So you can get an EPS that has a SCSI room like SCSI memory pack, but the memory pack is the SCSI port. So you can have the memory, but you won't have the SCSI port because you have to actually install that yourself. And this is what BreaksBeat has. He has the memory there. So it's saying, look, you can put SCSI in here because you have the card, which is the memory. But the way InSonic did it, it's like you have to build it after the fact or buy it all together at once. And that's what I had to do with mine. My EPS Plus came expanded, but it didn't have no SCSI. So then I had to go and buy the SCSI upgrade and install it myself. And in the review of the video, I show you how, you know, what it actually looks like from the inside. But if you ever buy yourself an InSonic EPS Classic or EPS 16 Plus keyboard, and it has that little SCSI thing in the back that says SCSI, you know, it says it on there, and there's no SCSI port on it, it's because you literally open it up, remove the blank panel, drop a D-sub cable port in there, wire it all up, close it back, and then you get your SCSI port. So it's like, you got to do some building if it doesn't come that way right away. And it's just one of the things that you got to do. But the problem is, other than up until very recently, there were no, you know what I mean? There, InSonic obviously wasn't selling those upgrades anymore because the company doesn't exist anymore. So you could just get memory and never be able to put in SCSI. But now you can, because there's people building it these days, which is a good thing. But that's the answer to his question. You have the RAM expansion, which actually houses the SCSI port, but you literally have to install it physically by yourself. So it's kind of funny. It's kind of like the SPDIF in and out on the ASR10. Like, you go back and you see the RCA cables there, and you think, okay, I can plug this in the SPDIF. You literally have to open it up and drop the SPDIF card in there. The ports are hardwired there, but there's no card attached to it. So unless you have the card attached, you can literally see the ports there, plug it in, nothing happens. Anyway, next question. This is from the video, how to chop samples on the InSonic ASR10 sampler. And AO says, I'm wondering why you spend so little time editing the start and end points of each chop. Isn't that the main work in chopping? He says, maybe I don't get it. And it's a workflow thing on these older machines. I'm trying to get some insight into the idea of chopping by ear versus waveform. Oh boy. So in this question, man, okay. This is, from what I'm seeing, it's like he's looking at what I'm doing and he's saying essentially like, why is it, either why are you doing this so quickly, or why isn't it taking you more time, or why are you not spending more time? Because in his mind, and it's not like I'm insulting him, this is a common thought, is that you should be putting in mad labor to chop things on a sampler, because that's sort of where, you know, the I don't know what, you're supposed to get some benefit from doing that. The answer is no. The main work of chopping, it's only work if you're not accustomed to doing it. You know, you can get just as fast on these machines as you can in a DAW if you work on them every day. It's not like some laborious decision-making process I'm making if I'm chopping up samples when I chop. Editing on the ASR10 or any of these samplers isn't really something that's laborious at all, but it would be if you don't use it every day, as anything else is. But chopping in an older sampler doesn't mean you have to spend time. And when you hear old people talk about, oh, you have to sit here and chop stuff and take time and that stuff, what they're saying is you actually have to put your hand on the gear and make a decision about where you want to chop. They're not really saying that it takes a million years to chop. They're just saying there's more of a thoughtful process in the act of chopping, meaning your brain is actually making a decision. Whereas if I put something in Ableton or in Machine or in an MPC, I don't have to think much. I could literally ask it, or the Octatrack, I could ask it to divide the sampler up into a million chops. I don't have to do a thing. But in the ASR10, I have to choose every single time where I want those chop points. Whether I'm quick at it or not isn't really here nor there. So that isn't to equate old samplers with some sort of like turmoil that you have to go to get the goal at the end. It's not like that, you know. So the idea of chopping by ear is just literally that. You hear something, when you're sample, when you hear something you like, you stop editing. When I move a sample point, I'm like, oh, I like it there, I'm done. I don't have to see anything, I can hear it. As a matter of fact, the truth of the matter is when you chop by ear, it is far more quicker than chopping by sight. Because when you're looking at a sample waveform, you have to listen and you have to see. When you're chopping by ear or editing by ear in general, all you have to do is hear. You could look anywhere else around you. You don't have to see nothing. You know, you could just be like, oh, I hear this, I like it. Like, what more confirmation do you need? That is quicker. It's less senses. You know what I mean? And it's a quicker decision-making process. The only time when it takes long is if you don't trust yourself and you need to see it. Well, that's, you know, that's a different thing. So that's the answer I would give. You know, chopping on an older sampler, if this is the way I'm not sure if I'm reading what he's saying right. I think I am. But, you know, it's not work is the way I would consider it. It's not work at all. And I can understand why he would think so, because old folk, including myself, we like to talk about these older samplers as if it's so hard to use these, and, you know, young people or whatever, newer samplers are just so easier now. It's not that. It's just different. And the difference is that you physically take a more active role in deciding what you want rather than having the machine do something for you that you should be doing yourself. That doesn't make it harder. That just makes it more of you. And that's a good thing. And it's not to say that you can't do that on a newer sampler either. All right. Next question is from sampling drums from vinyl on the, and this is the last one, and I'll go back to the chat. Sampling drums from vinyl on the InSonic ASR-10. This is a video where I pretty much lifted some drums off of Gold Revelation on vinyl. Many times, I've made so many videos, and this is probably the only video that I have where I actually show how to sample off of record, like, just because of the way YouTube is, it's like you can't really do it without getting struck. So I did it with my own record, which will not get struck. But, you know, it's something I wish I can do more of, because lifting samples off of vinyl, unfortunately, is becoming a real lost art. Like, you never think these things will ever become a lost art, and they are. They're just becoming lost. Like, people really don't know how to lift samples from vinyl anymore. Anyway, so that 12 kit says... So you put the sample on different instrument channels to get one sample, like snare on one, kick on two, hi-hat on three. Am I right? Yes, you're exactly right. Well, he's exactly right. That's not the only way to do it. That's the way I do it. I when I'm working on the InSonic samplers, I like to just eat up an entire track with one sample. I can have more control that way. I can shape the sound more. Every resource is on that track goes towards that one sample. I don't like doing kits because that's sharing too much space and too much. That's just, no, I don't get to control things the way I want. So I'll literally, one track one will like be a kick. Track two will be a snare. Track three will be a hi-hat. And the thing is, once you're using multiple samplers, it doesn't matter. If I need more, I'll just go to another sampler. It's very rare that I'll need more. And in electronic music, the music can sound busy, because a sample could sound busy, but that really doesn't mean the music has a lot of tracks going on. Like the average, I don't know, pick any electronic music track, it's not that busy. Of course, when you get to the more sort of busy electronic music, of course you can have like a million tracks, like the stuff I'm doing now. But in general, the music ain't that deep and it's not that difficult, you know? So I feel completely fine, especially if I was making hip hop music. 8 tracks is more than enough for what I'm doing. That's the answer to that question. And I'll head back to the chat for now. What's going on, CJ? Hey, what's going on, man? You good? Peace, Dejean. Peace. Everyone just checking in. Had the pleasure of showcasing your beats alongside some cats from your area. Are you familiar with Fresh Kills? I know of him. Most of the Canadian people, because he's a little bit older, so I know of him. I'm completely out of the tour. I know him by, like, I've seen him on online and stuff. Don't know him personally, but I'm aware of him. But as far as the Toronto scene goes, I'm well outside of that. I'm way older than the actual Toronto scene. But him I do know. I know a good amount of people in the scene, like just, you know, because I obviously want to know, but there's a lot of people, especially now in the Toronto scene, that I'm just unaware of. I'm too geriatric for that. But him, I do know. Yeah. So he was, anyway, back to what you're saying. So you got to play along. That's dope, man. Where, here or there? Obviously, where you are. That's wicked. That is dope, man. Good to hear. You're lifting a BJ sample from vinyl right now while listening to you. That's dope. BJ's got the dopest stuff you could take from there, man. All Disco Records, man. Disco Records have like the dopest snares. The best place to rip a hi-hat, a kick is from Disco. Strings, no brainer. Yeah, man. Your Technics turntable is down at the moment. You bought it on Craigslist and wonder if you got ripped off. The RCA cables, which aftermarket have you, which are aftermarket, have gone out. Oh well, that's interesting. You gotta, yeah, in Cincinnati. Okay, yeah, that's dope, man. Yeah, man, I do not. I'm completely out of the loop. Yeah, my I'm not in the scene at all, and haven't been in. I've never been in the Toronto beat making scene at all. MK2 from, oh, it just probably needs service. Yeah, if it's a 1200 from, yeah, and it's actually a true 1987 build, I don't think you got ripped off. It's just, you just need to service it. Yeah, it's old stuff, man. You just need to, yeah, you just need to get it serviced. It's not, I don't think you got ripped off. But if, yeah, if they've opened it up and put some aftermarket parts in there and they didn't tell you that, then that's kind of messed up. There's a YouTube video to replace them. Yeah, like if you got an old 1200, yeah, 1200s are like tanks. They did. Okay, yeah. This is why I say do not ever buy anytime. This is the exact reason I say it. Whenever you see gear and they've done something to it, don't buy it. Because that, it's not that they probably ripped you off. It's just because they either didn't do a good job or stuff like that. Like if. That's why I don't buy, like anytime I see a sampler and someone's done an upgrade to it, I'm not buying it. If I buy any vintage sampler or any piece of gear and they've done a modification, that immediately to me says I'm not buying it. Unless they've been like, the people who I would buy from would be like, look, there has been an upgrade. It's got done by this person. Here's the receipt. You know what I mean? And here's the warranty or whatever. That way, at least I know who did it. And the caliber of person, but if you just opened up a sampler and put your own floppy emulator in there, I'm not buying it. I'm like, I'll do it myself because I know how I would go about doing it. But if you did an upgrade, if you opened up and tinkered about it, I don't know you. I don't know what you did. I don't know. And you could have caused more problems than good. So I'm just not buying it. That's why I like buying things as they were. Give it to me the way it came from the factory. You know what I mean? And if you did anything to it, I need to see a record. If I'm going to pay the price that you're asking for, you know? Any advice on an appropriate replacement you could solder? I don't know anything about 1200s at this point. Yeah. I would say they're easy. Yeah. I would really say just get it serviced. But if you can do it, I'm pretty sure online, like LD4 was saying, online is your friend. All right, folk. Episode 233 of the Samplers Podcast is up right now. For those of you who are not on the Daydream Sound mailing list, you ought to be. Definitely take yourself down to the Daydream Sound website and get yourself signed up on the mailing list. You would have gotten mail. I mean, I said mail out every week, but you would have been on the mailing list if you'd have gotten stuff from me. And it's just a wonderful way for me to keep in contact with everybody, as that's my primary way of contacting people in the business. But aside from that, episode 233, alongside the topic of being overworked, episode 233 is about being overworked. Definitely want to check it out, as well as the other episodes at the Samplers Podcast. If you have not done so, please do so. And do take some time to look around at the Daydream Sound website for all types of stuff regarding samplers. There's tons of stuff going on there, including the music that I'm working on. This new album that I'm working on, man. Oh, my goodness. Oh. Music always kind of makes you feel uneasy. And this album that I'm about to put out, this, you know, whenever it's done, is so basic and so simple that I'm actually, like, you know, excited for it. Because it's the main task of this record is to be to not scrutinize so much and just let things go. That's been my main problem over these years. And I found that to be a crutch in my work. It's so easy to overmodulate and do stuff that's technically sound and kind of show off and do all type of stuff. It's sort of like hiding behind, it's sort of like an insecurity at that point, because it's easy to do. It's much harder to be raw in music, especially now. You know, it's difficult and it takes practice and it's a muscle that I've lost. So that's what this new record coming up is all going to be about. It's going to be about me really cutting back right down to the core of music and getting those fundamentals right and having the nerve to let that stuff go. So I'm, you know, I haven't been this sort of eager for music in a long time. And that's why I've gotten really, you know, I've been taking steps to get to this point, but I've gotten really comfortable in just being like, oh yeah, well, I can do this. I can do that. I can modulate. I can do all this stuff. It's like, so what, you know? I was beginning to, I think, lose a little bit about, you know, it's not like you can get lost in the music, but you can get comfortable. Maybe that's the better word. So that's what this new piece of music is going to be like. So I encourage you to join the mailing list for that reason, because I'm going to be giving more and more updates on the status of where I'm at. I don't think I'll be writing I've started a diary for this. I just, you know, it's difficult for me to keep up with it now. Maybe I'll release what I've written for this when I release the album. But that's where I am on a music level, if anyone is curious to know. But it's a good time for me musically. I'm doing good. Now, I think, let me drop into some more questions, because I want to get through these. There's plenty of them. So I'll drop into a little bit more questions. And then, once again, if anyone has questions about samplers or my opinion or my thoughts on things that you may find halfway interesting and want to know, feel free to ask. I'll answer the best way I can. So the question we have now is from How to Mix Down Your Hardware Sampler. So Pala B asks, can you send your whole mix through the inputs without sampling? Can you use it as a preamp? Yet again, we are, and I put up these questions just to show how much times I get the same sort of flavor of question. So this video is where I use the ESI 4000 to literally record an entire mix down with the goal of using it as a recorder. You know, these samplers have like tons of RAM in it, enough to hold like a 3 or 5 minute song. So when you record into these samplers, you could literally master to it or use it as a two track. The benefit is the conversion system in these samplers sound amazing. So you use that as a recording device and then you just bounce it back to wherever you want as it picks up the flavor along the way. But you literally have to do the transfer. Now, Pala is asking, well, that sounds like a little bit too much work for me. Can't you just like send it through there and then just get the sound of it? That would be a much easier, would it? Yes, it would. But these samplers don't do that. And no sampler would do that, because the goal of the actual process of sampling is what creates the sound. It's the change from analog to digital. And I would say at this point, maybe even the storage and recall of it and playback from the A to D may have something to do in the way the sound, you know, the whole conversion system works. That's where the sound comes from. If you're passing through it, there's no chance for that to happen. But here's the thing. You will get something, because anytime you pass a signal through any type of metal, any type of circuitry, something's going to happen. It may be good. It may not be good. but it's not going to be what you're traditionally expecting from the way a sampler inherently sounds. So the ESI 4000 sounds particularly amazing. It just does, along with all EMU stuff. And when you record to it or sample to it and play back your samples, you'll find that a tone comes from it. And because it has a good amount of RAM, you can mix down to it. You can do this with any sampler that you have enough memory to it. I do it with the ASR10. My ASR10 is 16 megabytes. That's going to give me like 3 minutes of, I could record a 3 minute song in there as a master. Now I can play it back real time into a DAW, but knowing that I picked up the sound of the ASR10 for free, you know? So it's just a process you want to take if you got time on your hands or if you really want to impart that quality. But the idea of passing something through and getting all these processes, which is a lot, isn't, you know, it's not something that these samplers do, nor were they ever meant to do. Even though you can, in many instances, pass audio through them, it's not the same as sampling and actually taking the sample, the audio, and making it digital and then reconstituting it back to analog. That process isn't happening in the same way as when you actually sample. That's why sampling actually takes time. Otherwise, it would be a much quicker process even today. So the next question we have is from, it's a video called What People Are Using Samplers For in 2020. And Antonio asks, is it true that the EPS 16 Plus, the EPS Classic is a 13-bit sampler? It is true. But here's the thing. So the EPS Classic by Insonic is a 13-bit sampler made in 1988. It samples at 13-bit. However, once the sample is digitally inside the EPS Classic, it's a 16-bit world in there. So its A to D is 13-bit. It can record at 13-bit. Inside the sampler, the architecture is 16-bit. Why even bother do that? Why not just keep everything 13-bit? My conjecture is that in a 16-bit world, you have more dynamic range. You have more, because if you're combining samples, you get more dynamic range. When you're sampling, well, you could only sample one thing at a time. So dynamic range isn't that much of a factor. So this time, 1988, was obviously a time when 16-bit wasn't the norm. It was like 16-bit was, I would imagine, expensive to achieve. So I think Insonic did this. I have no real concrete answer on why things are 13-bit, but I think they did it as a means to say, okay, well, we're going to come in at 13-bit, one better than 12, but inside, we're going to play at 16-bit, and then we're going to exit at 13-bit again, because once your sample is inside the sampler, well, then you could have any number of samples in there. So the 16-bit architecture benefits you, because what if you're playing like three samples at a time? What if you're playing the same sample on a chord? Well, your dynamic range is, you know, you're going to need more, as much as you can get. Maybe 13 bits is enough, maybe it's not. But if you have 16, you have more, you know. So I think that's why they did it. But it is true that it's a 13-bit, you know, if anything, you could call it a 13-bit hybrid. It's not 13-bit through and through. It's 13-bit on the in. And I'm not even certain that it's 13-bit on the, well, it can't be 13-bit on the out, but it's definitely 13-bit on the in. It's 16-bit inside. And then on the out, well, that's going back to analog. So I guess that really doesn't matter. I guess it's 16-bit out, I guess, back to analog, you know. So that's the story with that. And you will find that a lot of samplers did this, and samplers still do that. You'll find samplers may sample at 16-bit, but their internal architecture is like 24-bit, you know? I don't quite know why this happens. I can read up about it more and talk to somebody that's knowledgeable about why, other than the reason that I'm thinking, why they truly do this. But that's what the EPS Classic is doing. It samples at 13-bit, but once it's in there, it's in a 16-bit framework, which doesn't change the fact that it was actual sampled at 16-bit. It just has more room to play if it's being combined in other sounds. There's less chance of a clipping happening in a 16-bit architecture than 13, from what I think. Next question is from Vanguard, and the video is, What will hip hop be like in 10 years? And Vanguard asks, do you think it's possible to innovate boom bap? Yes, is my, like my immediate answer without even thinking. Like, I don't think, you know, the unfortunate thing about hip hop music is hip hop would have evolved at lightning speed had it been left alone, you know? And I guess it's the same for all genres, but in particular hip hop, because it literally took over an entire generation. And because there was an undeniable racial aspect to hip hop music, it hit different racial groups at different times and became successful over and over and over again. Right. So, you know, if you look at hip hop music, it started underground, like all genres, you know, then it blew up. Right. But the world at large still thought it was a fad. They didn't even know what it was. Then it got on the world stage, started winning Grammys, started, you know, showing up, and then people knew about it. So other people, you know, jumped on, and then it got popular all over again, but yet bigger, you know. Now hip hop is at the point where it's just seamless. You don't even think about it as ever being underground anymore. So because of that, the more eyes that get on it and the more people dipping into it as a financial art form, there's not much room for innovation. People just want more of the same. Had hip hop been left alone or maybe even been underground and not had, you know, gone through the things it would have gone through, it would have been able to innovate in peace. But right now there's no room to innovate because there's no time to innovate. If you need a hit, you need a hit now. And hits don't work when you're trying to figure out something new. Hits work by, you know, right now anyway, hits work by doing what was done before. That seems to be the formula of the moment. So there's no real room for it to grow. And the real problem of it all is people right now that make, that really respect the music and want to see it go forward, they're not really taking up the reins to make it go forward. Unfortunately, what they're doing is trying to reconstitute what has already been done. So while there's people that, you know, really, really enjoy the music and really respect the music from a production standpoint, meaning their artist, instead of moving the music forward or even thinking about it, what they're trying to do is relive the old days. So the music they make sounds old. You know, you listen to what you call underground hip hop now, and it sounds like it was made 25 years ago, because that's the era they're trying to reconstitute. They're not saying, okay, well, you know what? We should be pushing this forward. They're almost acting as if they don't see the music going anywhere forward. So I think when that mindset changes and people are like, you know what? We can go forward. Like, we don't have to look back. We've already had that history solidified. We don't have to relive it. It's not going to die. It's recorded. Let's move forward with the same respect and care that we should have taken before, you know. We'll see. So I definitely think it definitely could move forward easily. I don't even think it's a bigger issue than that. I think when people want to really take the music and give it a real kickstart and make something new, it will. Because it's one of the easiest genres to invigorate just because of its openness. That's my thoughts on it. Next question is did you know about the sample? Did you know about sample playback rates? Okay. So a little bit of talk about sample playback rates. You will find that in some advanced samplers, you know, you can sample at a certain sample rate. Like, we all know that you sample at, you know, I don't know, 22 kilohertz, 48, 41, you know, 48, 96. You sample at sample rates, but you can also play back your sampler. Once you have a really good sampler, it will allow you to play back at different sample rates. Some of them. And the EPS Classic and the EPS 16 Plus are two samplers that do that, where you can actually choose what sample rate you want to output at, or window. Look at the sample rate output as a window. That you, of course, when you sample something, it's locked in at that sample rate. There's not much you can do with the quality that you capture the sound at, but you could play it through a doorway that says, okay, this is the new sample rate which you're going to exit with. You're going to take whatever you are, and the only way you're exiting is if you pass through this window at this sample rate, right? So, Big Stereo VR is asking, did you choose 52 kilohertz out on the max on a max 204 kilohertz? Do we have different EEPROMs? So, Stereo has a EPS Classic, I can tell, but he's looking at my screen and he saw something that probably jarred him, because we know that the EPS Classic has a high sampling rate of 52 kilohertz. But here's one of the amazing things about the EPS Classic. It can resample at up to 312 kilohertz. So when he saw my screen, he saw me somewhere about 204 kilohertz sampling rate. And he's like, dude, what on earth? Like, what type of crazy sampler do you have? The EPS Classic can do that. You can resample something. Like, you could, your limit for sampling is 52 kilohertz. Your limit for resampling is blazing high. You'll see this sort of thing on the Synclavier as well. It resamples crazy high, you know, and the EPS Classic does this. Why? This thing, this sampler, like all 80 samplers, was made at a time before the CD took hold. So 44.1 was not really something written in stone. So when it came to sample rights, a lot of these manufacturers, to me, just chose sampling rates that, you know, that let you sample, that you pick what you want. By the time you get to the ASR10, they locked everything down. They're like, look, you sample at 48, 41, sorry, you sample at 41 or you sample at 32. That's all you get. You know what I mean? When you want to resample, your lock is 48. That's it. On the EPS, when you want to resample, you could sample all the way up to 312. Yes, your memory, I mean, you'll probably be able to sample nothing more than a snare. But imagine sampling at a sampling rate that high. This is 1988 we're talking about. So when he saw my screen, he's like, what did I just see? It's true. When you resample on the EPS Classic, you get access to these mega high sample rates. When I speak about high sampling rates being amazing, it's because they are. Not so much because of the way they sound, even though that's some of it. But if you know, if you're a sound designer, if you work with sound, high sample rates are they're the best thing you could ever ask for. So I may have a different EEPROM, but I don't think so. You know, I think you can do this on any EPS Classic, but that's what he saw. And it's a great thing. And to my knowledge, I mean, I can't do it on the EPS 16 plus, and I definitely can't do it on the ASR 10. I think both for sure the ASR 10, when you resample, like 48 is the highest you can sample on. I think on the EPS, you can get up to 72 kilohertz, but on the actual EPS Classic, you can go ripping high. Like, it's so the first time I saw it, I thought, like, this can't be right, but it's actually true. So that's the answer to that. So if any of you have an EPS 16 EPS Classic, resample something and just keep on moving that fader, and you'll see it just go up and up and up, and you're like, this can't be real. It's real. Next question is, in Sonic EPS Classic rack ambient, so this is like one of the music videos that I did on the EPS. And Evolution says, can you sequence tracks on the EPS plus ASRs? Can the tracks on the EPS be muted quickly on the fly, like maybe using a MIDI controller buttons? So he's asking, like, you know, can you control the muting of the tracks on these samplers remotely quickly? The answer is yes. You can do it through MIDI CCs, and it's fairly efficient. It's not that hard. Actually, it's one of the few MIDI CC controls you can do on these samplers. So fortunately, yes. And I've done it by controlling it before myself personally. I've done it by the off the track, been muting it, and it comes in real handy. There's a nice little group of things you can do with MIDI CCs on the InSonic samplers. Not many, but not much, but there is a handful of CC instructions that it will accept, and muting tracks is one of them. And you can do it fairly quickly once you program it through MIDI CC. So the answer is yes. Okay, we're almost done. Actually, this is the last question. This is from Basic Sound Synthesis on the InSonic ASR 10. This video got pretty popular very earlier on because I don't think there was ever a video of its type on the internet. This is one of the videos that people like be like, oh, you're the InSonic guy. But the Royal Crane says, got an ASR10 and I, it's a thank you thing. He says, got an ASR10 and I'm back to watching your videos to relearn this machine. You're a blessing to the community. Thank you. I wanted to put it up just to thank him personally for saying that. I appreciate it. You know, you do this stuff online, and you just don't think anybody cares or anybody, you know, really, you know, they just think your videos, you know. So it's nice to hear someone say thank you for that's been watching from this long. Like, this is a mega old video. So, you know, the fact that he now has gone to ASR10 years later and is going back to watching the videos and it's helping him is a nice thing for me to know that I make these videos whether I like them, you know, I like doing them either way, but I'm glad to know that it's helped because that's a good thing. That's the end of the questions for this week. For those of you who want to see the videos are all on this channel here, but you could check them out. There's tons of stuff here. Don't underestimate how much stuff is on this actual channel. But if you want more and you're like, yo, I want to see what you're doing right now online, NTSC Pal is for you. That is on the Daydream Sound website. I'm about to actually make a video. My next probably video is going to be sort of like a drum video. Like I said, I'm going to sample something, just a drum sound, a couple drum sounds, into the SB1200. And you're going to literally hear how hard the SB1200 cracks. And then I'm going to compare it with the original, obviously, that you hear. But I'm going to try to recreate that crack strictly using envelopes in any sampler. You know, most likely the Octatrack or the EPS or something like that. Just to show you that when you're using these samplers, you have a lot of control. And if you hear something on one sampler and you're like, oh man, I wish my sampler did that. Your sampler probably does do that. You just have to make it happen. And envelopes are your friend in that situation. Understanding how sound behaves over time is your friend. But if you can get a grasp on these things and understand how to recreate something, that is much cheaper and much more beneficial than buying a sampler just to do something that you heard. You know, like I said, there's other reasons to buy samplers that may suit your studio better. But to buy it just because of something that you could already do is on behalf of synthesis of all things is not what you should be doing. So definitely bring yourself down to the Daydream Sound and check out a NTSC Pal video. There's tons there. There's literally over 100, and they're long form videos. They're you know, for the most part, those videos, you know, are like 10 minutes and above. You know, the last video we did is like 40 something minutes long. So you know, I'm more inclined to do longer videos on my own platform than I am here on YouTube, for sure. It'd be appreciated more. And for those of you jumping in now that didn't see the beginning of the stream, I kicked off the stream. It's a rough start, but you know, if you could bear through the 5 minutes of silence, we spoke about this sampler here. This is called the Audio Frame. It's one of the epic achievements of the 80s in my view, but it's a very rare sampler. There's very little information on it, so I wanted to bring it to light so that we can uncover this stuff and learn as much as we can. But this is a 1988 sampler called the Audio Frame. It is massive. And if you look at it and it looks like a DAW, it's because I think DAWs of today that we work on right now stemmed from advances made in, you know, sampling technology. This sampler came with this big mainframe part that you see now, but it was also, you had to hook it, you had to look at it at a through a screen, which you see in the background, and a computer interface. It had a timeline just like samplers do now, and had a sequencer, sorry, just like DAWs do now, had a sequencer, had everything on it, but it sounded gorgeous. And there's audio examples of it online. I've never been able to see a real live video of it. I don't think there are very much of these made. Waveform Corporation is actually operational today. The company that made this, they're still operational today, but they just deal with software. But this is just a classic example of 80s excellence in sampling. This is a sampler that you're looking at right now. And I'll put on the next slide where you see the back. Look at the XLR collections on the back. These are all removable, you know, slots that you can add stuff at. So this was just, when you talk about hardware, this is what a hardware sampler looks like. You know what I mean? This is what you called gold hardware achievements, right? So when we compare this to the stuff we have now, you can see that more than anything, samplers, you know, are more akin to what you see in a DAW right now than you do. Like, this looks like a Pro Tools interface more than it does a sampler, because they're closely related. But when you look at hardware today, you don't see that, you know? So when you hear me speaking about gear right now being more akin to just not enough for me, this is what I'm talking about. When I look, every time I go back and I find these things in the 80s, and I'm like, this is where we were going, only to see stuff that's very small and very cute and doesn't even have real professional connections on it. This is what I mean. How did we go from this to where we're at right now? It's because this sort of thing is in the DAW now. Sampling sort of lives at its greatest achievement in the DAW right now. That's really the truth of it all, right? The most powerful sampler you can think of is in software right now. That's not, you know, I'm not saying nothing crazy. That's the truth. But you can see why when you look at gear like this from the 80s. So I want to, you know, just bring that up for anyone who's like into sampler history. Definitely, you know, dig this sampler up, you know, check out the specs of it. The specs are impressive. It sounds impressive. You can hear it right now online. Great stuff. It's called the Audio Frame. It was made in 88. It's a 16-bit sampler. It's just everything you would want and more in a sampler in the 80s. It cost $88,000 in 1988. So that was the price of like two houses. You know what I mean? So, you know, definitely check it out. But I just wanted to bring that up because we spoke about that at the beginning of the stream for anybody who's into that sort of thing. But it's wonderful stuff. I could give you some advice to any of you that have old school direct drive turntables. Do not sell them. Ain't that the truth? Oh boy. You love how you love low sample rates like butter to your ears. Yeah, I mean you get sample rates are, you know what I mean? They're what the sampler gets to see your audio from. You know what I mean? And depending on how your what lens your sampler is wearing, your audio is going to sound a different way. Like once you come in from the analog world, and you pass through a certain sample rate and a certain bit depth, that's it. It's unchangeable. You can't undo that. So sample rates are incredibly important. And when you get to choose different sample rates, it just makes a whole different flavor, and it's a different look than sampling something and then resampling in the box. Like that sounds different. I've done videos here on YouTube showing that you could sample something and then resample it at a sample rate. It doesn't sound the same as if you sample at that sample rate right off rip. It's two different things. Sample rates are a very subtle but very useful tool when it comes to samplers, as you would expect. You want to try that sample rate process on the EPS. Didn't know it can go that high. Yeah, man. And that's what I mean. Like, when you get these older 80s samplers, they let you touch stuff. That's what I mean. Like, a newer sampler would never let you do that. Like, you would never see that on a newer sampler. Like, it literally wouldn't even make sense to them. Like, why would they let you do that? On the EPS 16 Plus, you can literally choose a sample rate that's up to 312 kilohertz. That means a lot. You know what I mean? The more and more resolute you can make your digital audio, it's great for many things outside of the way it sounds. You know what I mean? Like I'm trying to hold back on what I want to say as far as the benefits you get from it. But if you know, you know, you know? So it's like, you know, that's an amazing thing. I would say it is a Fairlight successor. You know what I mean? It's where samplings would have, if sampling, just like hip hop, if samplers were left to being like, if samplers really got the traction that they could have, we would be seeing something else. But I think that DAWs actually replaced in a large part or took over or improved or sort of transitioned from what samplers are now. So, you know, maybe we've been looking in the wrong spot. Maybe we've been saying, oh, like hardware, when we really should have been like, oh, like, you know what? Samplers were always going the way of the DAW. From the get-go, samplers have always had screens on them, even from the earliest ones, even from the Peter Zinoviev thing. It was a computer with a screen on it. Samplers have always had screens and keyboards. And somehow we've got it into our mind that samplers are keyboard samplers or rack samplers, when that's not the truth. The earliest samplers had keyboard, like all of them, now that I'm thinking about it. The Peter Zinoviev one was literally a tomato can computer that they retro, that, you know, they hacked to be a sampler. So that had a screen and a keyboard. Then there was the Music Melodeon had a keyboard and a screen. Then the Fairlight keyboard, screen, light pen, the Sinclair keyboard, screen. And then things changed up. You know, then we started seeing emulators and all types of other stuff that were strict keyboards. But samplers from the get-go have always been these things that looked very much like a computer. And if we forget that, we start to sort of make up our own history. But you just got to look back at it and be like, no. Really, you know, your DAW, you know, take out all the other fuzzy stuff, but it's really more to what sampling is than an actual ASR-10 is. And there's a reason why your DAWs are, you know, when it comes to samplers. So maybe that's it, you know. Maybe we've been complaining all these years about stuff that we really shouldn't be because we don't know our history as well as we should. But it's interesting to look back at this stuff and maybe sort of reevaluate the hard and fast opinions that we have about this stuff. And I'm speaking more about my opinions on stuff, but when you look at it in real, like in timeline, you're like, well, yeah, you know, look at that. Look at this. Like, look at that. That's a DAW. I mean, just on first glance, if I showed you this, because you could see the screen, like it's got music stuff at the back. Like if you saw this, you would akin this more to like a Pro Tools setup than you would a sampler. But when I tell you this is a sampler, that's all it is, you know. This is a straight sampler with a music arranger, like it like, you know what I mean? But it's a sampler. That's what it's marketed as. That's what it's supposed to be, you know. Today, samplers don't look anything like this. But I just named four samplers that are all built on that same model. Mainframe, screen, keyboard, mouse, or some sort of input device, be it a light pen, you know. So I just went down the line. I went the Peter Zinoviev makeshift sampler, the first sampler. Then we got the Computer Music Melodeon, screen. Sinclair Fairlight, screen, light pen. Waveterm by PPG, screen. You know what I mean? Keyboard. Like they, all of those things are just like this. So come to 1988 now with this thing, like that's just like, you're right. It's like a successor. And, you know, its price was appropriate. But, you know, we got to know this stuff or at least not forget about it. Because like I was saying earlier on in this stream, I didn't know about this sampler till last year. I had no idea it existed. I didn't know. I found it by mistake. And even when I saw it, I saw the picture, but I didn't think it was a sampler. It wasn't until I started reading, I'm like, hold on, that's a sampler? You know what I mean? I'm like, who's this company? I've never heard of this company before, you know? So I'm really sort of trying to find out more, if there were any more stuff like this. Maybe there's more, I don't know. But it's crazy to see where we came from. But it really solidifies my opinion that I have of hardware stuff now. I'm just not, you know what I mean? I don't mean to sound pessimistic, but look at that, you know, that's 1988. It's just really, really impressive, I think. Or maybe what we're doing now is really, really lackluster. I don't know. Take your pick. I don't know. You love how your SB202 sample snares, you love throwing those into the EPS to get a lot of grains and decays. You love doing that type of stuff. Yeah, man. Playing around with your sound and developing your sound is sort of like really developing your palette. And that's your signature, right? It's not like now we speak about these things, so we're more inclined to actively do this. But that sort of thing happens naturally. When you work in your studio, your sound just comes to you by the way you work. And it's not like you may be doing it intentionally, but that's why, you know what I mean? Like, there's certain artists I listen to, and I mean, like, why do you sound like that? You just have a sound. And they're like, I don't know. I don't hear anything. I'm like, yo, you sound like something. Like, how did you get that? And they'll be like, I don't know. Like, that's just the way I work. You know, that's how your sound comes to you. When you hear an artist and you're like, yo, you just sound different. You're using the same thing I'm using. Like, why do you sound like that? It's because your sound just comes to you by working and just developing your palette. And before you know it, people start telling you you sound a certain way. And you don't even hear it. You're like, what are you talking about? You know, that's the way this stuff happens. But it comes from just milling about and making music in your studio so much that all of a sudden you have a signature. That's a good thing. You know, it's really good. I said you sampled yourself hitting a Corona bottle with a pencil and use that for a closed hi-hat sound. You got me getting creative with Daydream. Yeah, it's cheaper to do it. You know what I mean? Once you get into these samplers, they're so powerful that you could, you know what I mean? You have all the shaping tools you need. I'm not saying don't buy anyone's sample packs and stuff, but I'm saying it's just easier to do it yourself. You know what I mean? It's more gratifying, I should say. I guess it's easier to buy something, but it's more gratifying to really have a palette of sounds. And I find that when you make your own sounds, you don't need a lot. You really don't need a lot. You can make one kick and like by way of synthesis, you could just recycle that kick a million times. It'll never sound the same, you know? And not only that, it will definitely not sound like anybody else. The song I'm working on right now, I made a kick on modular and it's just like, there's no way I could have made it anywhere else, but I've never heard any kick like that before. And it's like, holy smoke. You know what I mean? And I, before, you know, that's before I even start really doing anything creative to it, you know, it's because I made it, you know, 88K is why you don't see them. Yeah. The company, but the thing is, well, look at the Fairlight and the Synclaver, they were expensive. They just took off. I just think by the year 1988, samplers had already gotten popular enough and accessible enough that it was like, okay, I can sample. Like, I don't need an $88,000 sampler. I can get, like, an Emulator 3, which was expensive, but I can get that instead, you know? I think the commitment to sampling was no more as novel as it used to be in Fairlight and Synclavier days that it really didn't get to pick up. It's just like kind of like how you look at the Moog One today. The Moog One's out there. You know, stuff like the Matrix Boots and big, like, mega, the Waldorf Quantum, it's out there, but it's so top tier that's like, okay, only some people are going to get it, but everyone else is just going to get any other synth that covers, you know, that can do this, you know, that does the job, but it's not at that level, you know? But that was, you know, that was the Quantum of the time. That's a beautiful, you know, it's a beautiful example of what I'm saying about, like, when I look at samplers now, I'm just like, no, I'm not getting an SP404. No, like, that it's just not enough, you know. Are you doing volume smoothing on your homemade snares? No, man, I don't do much. To me, like, when I guess you wouldn't see it. Like, my sound design sessions, like the way I make stuff is on literally on NTSC PAL. But I can explain it to you. I literally go outside with any old mic, hit something. By the time I get it in these samplers and shape it, that's all it takes. Like, I don't have to do any crazy stuff. A lot of what I rely on is synthesis in the sampler. So the way I see the sampler is, I like the way you sound because I bought you, so I don't really care about what you sound like. It's just more if the sound lends to what I'm doing. If I need something blazing heavy, I'll put it in the S950, but the S950 may not have the envelopes I like, so most likely I'll put it in an all-around winner like an EPS Classic or ASR10 because I can make, or an EPS 16 Plus, because I can make that go a number of ways. But what I rely on is the actual synthesis in there. When I have two-stage five-point envelopes, I can't miss. Like, that's all I need. When I have a filter that I could modulate over time, and I could do a number of things, I don't need much to make my snares or whatever sound like how I want them. And mind you, I'm not really into, like, when I record a sound, like, that's it. Like, that's, I already like it. So I'm not trying to do much. I'm just trying to make it, like, maybe sound more aesthetic. If I need something to hit really hard, I'll just put it in the SB1200 and call it a night. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not going to spend all that time if I'm working on a song where, okay, I need my drums to slap hard. That's why I have different looks of samplers. I'm not going to spend time shaping. I'm just like, okay, you go here because I know what you're going to do to this sampler. But I don't do much. I really don't do much. I rely heavily on the sound itself and synthesis. And a lot of times it's just simple envelope, filter, amp. That's it. No, like, when I say amp, I mean amplitude envelope. That's it. Nothing crazy. I don't do none of this crazy stuff. But my music isn't aggressive anyway. My music's pretty soft, you know, kind of pillow music. So I don't need nothing hard. But if I do, yeah, I might consider some other stuff. For volume smoothing, believe it or not, I use volume smoothing for more like ambient sounding tones because it eliminates all the dynamics and I could just make stuff like just one big wash. You know what I mean? If I pull out all the dynamics and if I can make, you know, ant stepping on the ground sound as loud as a jet taking off, that's crazy. You know what I mean? But now I have this big wash of sound that I can then reshape with something else. But for drums, I don't take drums too seriously in my music anyway. It's just a nature, but that's for the style of my music, right? If I was making hard-hitting music, I'd just do different things. Yeah, sample packs are weird and the lazy producers never got that. I never used to understand sample packs later either until I started using them. And then I understood why later, you know what I mean? Do I leave cutoff at 20 on everything? No, it's different every time. I do different things. I can't, you can never do the same. I mean, you could, but it's leaving a lot on the table. Every sound, when I tell you every single sound I treat differently, I literally treat every sound differently because you have to. I can't just, like I don't, the numbers mean nothing to me. What the numbers do on the sound means something to me. So everything is different. Everything has a different time. Everything has a different shape. Everything's different. So those numbers are just something that I have to adjust around the sound, but they can never be the same. Yeah, nothing is the same, especially when you're dealing with samples. Unless you're dealing with the exact same sample, every single thing is different. Every setting I do is different in order to get the sound that I want. You maximize the aliasing filter and the sample 6.12, 11.2, never get higher than that. I know. Your kicks are always at 15. Yeah. Yeah, I don't work that way. I just, like, everything, anytime, like, I just, sample rates are kind of like they're like a shaping thing to me. So based on the way I think the sampler is going to see something, I'll kind of have an idea, you know, but I'll sample it. And if I don't like it, I'll try another sample rate that I, you know, that may suit what I'm doing. And then that's it. But a lot of times this happens quick. A lot of the times I'm just going to a sampler because lock, stock, and barrel, I like what it does. Like it doesn't get that technical unless if I'm working with a sound that I really need to figure out, then I'll kind of do all the things I just said. But on a regular day, I'm literally being like, oh, I want this gritty, it's going to Mirage. Oh, I want this heavy, it's going in the S950. And I don't do much because the sampler itself does all the work. But if I'm actually being like, okay, I want this sample to sound another way and I can't figure out, like, I actually need to do something, then I'll do work, you know, I'll do some forensics on it. But that's not my everyday way of working. Like, I don't sit there, like, tweaking too much. Unless it's a sound design day or sometime when I just feel like, you know, doing that sort of stuff. But that's really not the bulk of what I work. The bulk of my music making process goes more towards arrangement, really making sure that the song sort of evolves the way I want it to, having the sounds actually sound the way I want them to, reevaluating, re-listening, thinking like, okay, does this even need to be here? You know what I mean? Those sort of decisions. But generally, or troubleshooting stuff, but generally, you know, I'm not doing all this sort of like making drums hit or making sample, like it's just really, it's much quicker than that. Sample pass can have just as much impact on people and culture as a sampler. Oh, that's for sure. That's already been, yeah. Mixing to 432 hertz right now. What's going on, Sarah? 25 on the sample rate is golden for samples. Daydream, can the micro granny sample the snares as grainy as a Mirage? You haven't tried it? Probably. Yeah, I mean, like, it's just, it's all, I mean, I'm not one for that sort of thing. I use that stuff sparingly, but it's just, I have a couple examples on here online. It's just a different look, close, but not the same. And you're not going to get as much control on the sound as that. And the Mirage, on the other hand, like, it naturally doesn't sound like crazy gritty like how the micro granny is. Like, you're gonna have to take, you have to sample at a lower sample rate on the Mirage to really get down to those, that sort of grunge that the micro granny will just go to. But it's hard to control on the micro granny because there is no control. It's just pretty much fixed at a certain sample rate and it just kind of does what it does, and the quality isn't as good, like nowhere near. But it, yeah, I wouldn't buy any of those samplers just for that. I would literally use a plugin and be very happy. I wouldn't do all that stuff. Yeah, the Mirage is smooth and creamy. Well, it just has a lot of range. Like, there's a lot going on in there. The analog filter does count for a lot, but it's two different looks, but I'm not into that texture too much. It's got a strong personality, and for the music I make, because sometimes my music gets busy, things that are 8-bit and that pronounced, they take up a lot of space, and they're just loud. You know what I mean? They're very, very noticeable. And if you're trying to make music in that sense, it's either you work with them in very short instances, like you have a snare that's 8-bit, that's never really going to bother anybody, or you have a big long 8-bit sampler, it's just going to eat up everything. It's going to be like, I'm here, listen to me, listen to how gritty I am. And it commands too much attention, where I'm more likely to just drop a filter on it to make it lay back a little bit more or something like that. It's just the nature of the music that I make most of the time that has me steer away naturally from really aggressive sounding stuff, because my music ain't aggressive. If I made more aggressive stuff, I'd be saying something different to you. Or if a song I was working on was more aggressive, I'd be saying something different. That's why, you know, that's why I'm saying what I say. It's just, I'm thinking about it in a more context of the stuff I generally make. It's really sort of music that would engulf you. And if I make anything where something is sticking out too much or commanding too much attention, you're just going to focus on that in the mix, and it's not going to get to embrace you the way I need it to, or sort of carry you the way I need it to. So whether that happens or not, that's a different story, but that's sort of my, you know, the vibe that's coming out of the music. Now, if I want to make something where I want the drum beats to just tear your head off, different story. Way different story. I would do something different. It would be a different application. No, the Mirage is a different beast. You have the Casio SK1-8 keyboard, and it's nothing like the Mirage. Yeah, the Mirage, I mean, you can't compare any of that old stuff to the new. Like, first of all, the SK1, I mean, that was a toy. But the Mirage, you know, whether everything lined up the way it did, it's a sampler with a coveted filter in there that's really nice, and it just does 8-bit in a way that's become very, very popular, almost one of the standards for 8-bit audio, because the Mirage was mega popular. Like, the Mirage is like the SP-404 of its day. It's cheap, everyone had it, you know, everyone knows what it sounds like, and you hear it on hit records, you know. It's all over Janet Jackson stuff, all over Public Enemy. Like, you know what the Mirage sounds like. Whether you know it or not, you've been listening to the Mirage all your life. So when you get one, you become very familiar and attached to its aesthetic. That's just my thought on it. Like, I was listening to Mirage before I even knew I was listening to Mirage. And going back now and being like, oh, that was Mirage? You know, when you get one in your hand, you're like, okay, you know. So I think that a little bit of that what's going on. So to compare to 8-bit stuff, like, 8-bit doesn't mean anything. You know what I mean? 8-bit low sample rate, high, it doesn't mean nothing unless it sounds good. There's terrible sounding 16-bit. We've all heard terrible sounding 48 and 96-bit. It's really how good it sounds when it comes to that sort of thing. And the Mirage does 8-bit pretty uniquely. It's the only way I could consider it, because sometimes it's so harsh and so crazy that you're just like, this is way too much, but yet it could sound good. But I've never really heard any sampler that I have or I've ever heard do 8-bit like that thing. And that's a good thing, because, you know, and be able to go so many different directions. You know, you own a Mirage, you'll be surprised how clean it can get. It can get clean. You know, same with the SP. I could play a sample through the SP and you would never tell. You would never know. You would never be like, oh, that sounds like an SP. You just wouldn't know. You're working on the EPS right now. You might try it. Oh, with sampling. Yeah, man. But that is it. So folk. Oh, you know what I wanted to ask? The thumbnails. This is a bit of input here that I'm looking for. So the thumbnails for the live streams now, I've been putting up the date. Is that helping anybody? I'm expecting so, because now you can see dates, and I'm seeing on the back end people are going back and watching the older stuff, something I never thought would happen. So that's absolutely amazing. But do the thumbnails actually help with the date up in the corner where you can see, like, you know what I mean? Is that helping anybody, like, you know what stream is different from others, or do you even not see it? Like, should I do something else? Is it working? Let me know your thoughts, because since we're leaving these streams up, and I guess the good thing is happening is, like, I've just been looking at, you know, the analytics this week, and, like, people are going back and, like, it's absolutely insane to me, but they're starting to be watched. Like, that's just, I don't know. I think it's a good thing. I think it's great. But I just, you know, the reason why I took these down in the first place, because I just found them, you know, I didn't think anyone would want to listen to this sort of long form content with no, I'm not making beats on here. I'm not on camera. It's just literally like a radio show. So I'm happy that that's working out. But my only, like we were saying earlier, like the only problem is, like, how does anyone know one from the other? So the dates, I hope it works, but let me know if it helps. Off topic, tedious kind of one. The reason why you don't want to rely on artist music platforms, UMG and TikTok, lease contract, and UMG lease contract, MCA lawsuit against Pandora free app, because royalties headache for. Oh, hold on. Let me try and figure out what you're saying. One of the reasons why you don't want to rely on artist music platforms, UMG and TikTok. The thing going on between UMG and thing. Well, I think you should never. I don't think you should never rely on anything like that. Yeah, I agree. But yeah, that's there's so many reasons why you would want to be as in control of your own, of anything that's yours in your life. You know what I mean? One of the reasons just being straight up control and control over exposure. But I think if you're going to be an independent artist, that is control. You know what I mean? So when you take something and more than anything, you're going on something else like TikTok or anything like that. That's not even a music platform. You hold on, guys. Sorry, guys. When you're working as an artist on an independent level, I can't remember what I was saying last, but you want to be able to control your own stuff. And it's too easy to do now to not do it. Like, I think people shy away from taking real control of their music and actually selling direct to artists, because that's the hard part. When you can just put your music up on Spotify or any of these sites and just random traffic finds you or may not find you, you don't have to do anything except watch to see if your song takes off or hopefully gets picked up by a list and you feel like you're popular. You're missing the point of being an artist. One of the greatest advantages is you get direct contact with your listener base when you do it yourself, except it's work. You literally have to find people to listen to you one by one. And a lot of people realize that that's not that easy to find someone to literally listen to your music, not passively, actively. So they avoid it in lieu for just putting your music on somewhere where traffic passes and you don't really have to go out and be like finding people, because how do you do that? You know, that's the trick. So most people hide behind these sites just to save their own ego, because it's nice to see a song of yours get like, you know, 30,000 plays. To me, that would hurt because you don't know any of those 30,000 people, or even if they like you, or if they, even if they really meant to listen to you. You know, maybe if your song just washed by in a playlist, maybe they don't like you at all. You know what I mean? But when you could actually find one person and they literally go back and write you and follow you and be like, look, I want to know anything that you release. That one person, you could count that to be like 100 people. Because those type of people stick with you for life. You know, and you build that way. And that's how you grow. And that's outside of playing live. Like if I was playing live right now, it'd be so easy because that's the best way. You know what I mean? Playing live in front of people is like, that's as direct as it gets. But doing it online, you literally have to do it person to person and person, and it grows and it's work. But that's the way I would do it. So to rely on something like TikTok, you know, you could get a lot of views. That doesn't mean anything, and it's not sustainable. We see that over and over again. You know, that's why you could see people that could blow up on TikTok and then they put up an album or anywhere and then it gets like, it really doesn't get any traction. And they get confused about it. Thumbnails are perfect. Oh, thanks. Great. That's what perfect. That's what I really wanted to know, because I'm going to leave these up, but I hope there's a way to distinguish one from the other. And that's exactly what I wanted to hear. You missed a lot of streams in a month, so it helped. Yeah. You know, I'm seeing like they're getting, it's slow, and that's a good thing, but it's actually more than what I thought. That's a good thing. Daydream, will you ever bring the Thursday streams back? Those were the best. You were able to tune in while at work. Work Sundays are hard for you. Well, the thing is, man, I'm not able to keep up that rate anymore. You know, I'm really moving really like, you know, hard into the music. And that just means I'm not, you know, I just don't have the time to do all of that anymore. So Sundays work the best for me. And remember, it's just replay, man. You could always, you know, you could always come back and listen, but I can't, you know. Yeah, my primary thing is music. And that needs a real kickstart. You know what I mean? So I really need to focus on that. It's a lot of knowledge. Glad you're leaving them. Thanks, man. That's good. That is good stuff. You notice the date immediately. Great. Wicked. Thank you. Yeah. That's what I really wanted to hear, man. Much appreciated, you know, LD40. I really appreciate that. I'm glad the dates are really doing their thing. Yes, the thumbnail day is visible. Great. Perfect stuff. Exactly. Haven't tuned in for a while, but it's always refreshing to hear your talk about sampling and anything music. Reminds me, you're not crazy. You get why people listen back. Yeah, man, that makes me, I can't understand that one, but I'm so happy for it. I never wanted to leave these things up exactly for that reason. So I'm glad that it actually works out. Well, we are here and I'm about to be out. This was a nice long stream. You know, for those of you who are listening, the first 5 minutes or so, you know, I thought I was talking through the mic and I wasn't, but bear with it. I think this was a good stream. I'm very much appreciated. If you have not taken a trip down to the daydreamsound.com, please do. Pinned to the top of this site, of this chat, is the daydreamsound.com. Have a look at the website. See what you like there. I've bundled some of the, History Never Gets Old with Gold Revelation, so that if you're ever thinking to purchase them, it's there for you to get one time. as a bundling thing. If you haven't joined the mailing list, please do. If you haven't listened to the Samplers podcast, please do. If you haven't checked out any of my music, oh my stars. Oh man, you are missing out. But yeah, like I said, this whole year, I'm really at a point where the company could actually start focusing on what it was set out to do. I've built enough of a infrastructure that I can, you know, what do you call it? Platform that I could leap off of. So I'm able to do music now much more than I need to without having to, you know, really tend to so many things going on with the business. Sort of has legs now, and it takes that amount of time. It's taken me since 2014 till now to give this company some legs, and it's got some legs now, so I'm happy that I can actually start working now. But thanks so much for listening. Very much appreciated. Thanks for the feedback on everything. I'll definitely tune in next week, same time. Take care. Be kind. Again, much appreciated, man. Thanks so much for your interest in Samplers. I'll catch you on the next one. Take care. Peace.